against Celtic.
Okay, lads, this is a big one. It's a six-pointer. I want to see passion, commitment. Fight for every ball. And remember, you're a team, so go get them.
Last weekend, Colin Cameron darts in to make it a double top. Celtic, though, soon hit a treble, and it's a three-way tie for the title. But yesterday at Ibrox, Rangers couldn't check out Dunfermline, so a maximum for either side today, and they hit the bullseye.
Yes, the outright lead of the Premier Division up for grabs at Tynecastle this afternoon. The home team arriving at the stadium here a short time ago for the biggest match of the season so far. Hearts out to end their Old Firm hoodoo. Celtic looking to make it three wins out of three against Jim Jeffrey's side in the championship chase. Hello, good afternoon from Tynecastle. A three-way thriller for the title and a quite titanic tussle in prospect here today. Hearts against Celtic live and exclusive here on Scott Sports. Stay tuned for all the build-up, pre-match interviews and the latest news in the run-up to kick-off. And joining me here in our Tynecastle studio, a man who's clocked up one or two air miles in the past week, Scotland coach Craig Brown. I'm delighted to have you here, Craig.
Thanks.
And I think a cracker is in store today.
Well, obviously, I think after yesterday's result at Ibrox, it gives a great incentive to the winning team here. If someone can win the match, they'll go to the top. So a great game in prospect, I think.
How are you feeling? Jet lag?
No, not at all. No, looking forward to this afternoon's game. I've seen Brazil and hopefully we'll see better today.
Good stuff, Craig. Well, the two teams are here and so is Paul Cooney, who's down in the best place of all, the boot room here at Tynecastle. Over to you, Paul.
Absolutely, Jim. Craig Brown was saying a mile high. You must have been a mile high when you heard the score at 20-5 at Ibrox yesterday, Jim.
Yes, well, when Dunfermline got the equaliser, there was a wee bit of a cheer went up for the camp, but there'll be a lot of points, as we said, won and lost between now and the end of the season, so there's a wee chance now. It just gives a wee bit of edge today. The team that wins will go to the top of the league with a couple of points. So.
And yet maybe that's the kind of luck you need. You need luck to be winners, don't you?
Well, it's no case of luck. You know, you make your own luck, and we've been consistently doing well this year. That's what's made us at the top, even though we haven't taken a point off the Old Firm, so what a good way to start now.
Jim, what's the news? What about, first of all, Gilles Rousset? Is he making it for this afternoon?
No, Gilles is out. Roddy McKenzie, who stood in for him really well in previous games, he felt his groin, so it's a game we can't take any risks. If he had to come off it, you mean we've been in trouble, but I'd rather have three outfield players on the bench, so he's not 100%, so Roddy will keep his place, and he's been doing well.
Wim Jansen said last weekend that the league really starts now. There's just one point between, well, you and Celtic are together, one point with Rangers. Can you beat the Old Firm?
Yeah, there's no reason why we can't. excuse me, as Dave McPherson said a couple of weeks ago, it's not how many times you beat them, but when you beat them. So if we start now, then obviously we're in the driving seat, and you know, with 12 games to go, then who knows?
And it's going to be a full house here in just under an hour's time. It's going to be some atmosphere, isn't it?
Oh, it'll be fantastic. I mean, it's a sellout now, we've just been told, and with the way the stadium's built now, it's going to create a great atmosphere, and if the players can't play in that atmosphere, then they'll never be able to play. So it's all the makings of a cracking game. Both teams like to get it down and play attacking football, so hopefully it'll be a great game with Hearts coming out on top.
And it's live, exclusive and free, but I can't tempt you out the dugout. I take it you'll be there. We'll be watching it on the telly. Jim, all the best this afternoon.
Thank you.
Thanks, Paul and Jim. Well, whoever wins today and takes over at the top should post a thank you card to Dunfermline's Harry Curran. It was his last-minute goal that silenced Ibrox and put another dent in Rangers' quest for 10 in a row.
Richard Gough leading out Rangers. He was one of only two Scots in the starting lineup, the other being Stuart McCall. And the Finnish goalkeeper there, Antti Niemi, in from the start for this one. and Rangers dominated from the word go. Brian Laudrup trying to set up Tony Vidmar, and it was beaten out there by Ian Westwater. Stuart McCall couldn't finish. Rangers continued to push forward. McCall put through Negri, but Westwater got down well to save. Negri back, of course, after his eye injury. Rangers kept it going. Gascoigne looking for an opening. The shimmy, the shot, and it was just wide. But still, Rangers couldn't get the breakthrough. The same story in the second half. George Alberts in on goal, and he knocked it just wide. How long could Dunfermline hold out? Gascoigne there, setting up Vidmar, and Perinian on goal. And again, Westwater beat it out. Surely the break would come. Corner Rangers, Vidmar headed it down, and Laudrup blazed it over the top. 0-0 it remained, though. And frustration may be creeping in. Laudrup in the box where he's deadly. The chip to the back post. Gattuso was there, and Perini had a go. So did Negri, and somehow Westwater kept it out. Maybe it wasn't going to be Rangers' day. Negri and Dave Barnett having a chat off the ball. Westwater in replay there doing very well. Gascoigne on the charge. Barnett watched him closely. He played it wide, and then Gattuso had a go, but he knocked it wide. And the Rangers fans now unhappy. Something had to give. It's headed off the line, and Perini headed home. At long last, the Rangers breakthrough from the skinhead of the Italian. The header beat everyone, and Rangers at last were ahead. And could they build on that? Well, Jury thought so. He played it inside for Negri, but uncharacteristically there, the finish well wide. Rangers were looking for more. They looked as though they'd get them. Gattuso had a go again, and it was just inches wide. So much domination, so many chances, so few takers. Alberts with a shot. Again, Westwater kept it out. And then, what do you know, in the 90th minute, Dunfermline nicked a draw. Smith with a shot, Niemi kept it out. Bjorklund couldn't get to Harry Curran in time, and the substitute scored. In replay, the Swedish defender might just have blocked Curran's shot, but it flew by Niemi, and 1-1, amazingly, it finished.
They're a good team, and we knew they were going to have a lot of pressure, so we decided just to sit in, let them attack us, and we would try and get them in the break. That's what happened.
Dunfermline, struggling to stay out of the relegation zone, you know, so nobody blames them for that. It's up to us to come and break them down. We did all that we could there without actually getting the clear couple of goals away from them that would have eventually killed the game. And as you saw in the last seconds of the game, they put all the players up into the box, which, they've got nothing to lose at that time. And as I say, we didn't clear it properly, and that cost us 2 points.
Yes, so more valuable points dropped by Walter Smith's side, although the result does actually edge them out in front again at the top of the table. But Craig, the good thing there is it's refreshing to see Dunfermline going at them right at the end and coming away with something.
Yeah, well, I think, as Harry Corden said, they did sit in, and when they do that, it's very difficult to break them down. We found that, you know, against the lesser international teams, particularly when they come here, they don't want to win the game, they just want to get a draw if they can. Now, Dunfermline admitted that, and of course, with Bert Payton, Dick Campbell and Jimmy Bowen there coaching, you can be assured that they'll be well organised.
Because they want answers, don't they? They want effort and answers. Well, we can see, Craig, the top of the table, we can see just how close it is. Well, there we are. Rangers are a point ahead. And, Craig, we don't need any reminding from that this game this afternoon is so vitally important.
Oh, yeah, a huge incentive for both teams today. And I think the managers down there will need to say nothing. Just show them that league table and say, out you go, guys. And quite clearly, a victory puts you at the top. And when you're at the top, you know, you're in a very good position because that sets the standard, and of course you can set the pace for the rest of the season.
You liked Perini's goal, I think, didn't you?
He
placed the header well, and at that stage, Craig, it looked as if Rangers were going to play all day without scoring.
Yeah, well, I commend Perini. He's up there, and he's not anchored in defence, and he headed it very well against a,
three or four players in that goal line, and he picked his spot very well indeed.
And here's Curran at the other end, and Yemi makes a good save.
I felt sorry for the goalkeeper. I thought he saved it well, but he had no chance with the second one, which Harry Curran put away very well indeed. But a bit unfortunate for the goalkeeper that it broke out to the Harry, to the Dunfermline player.
And a great moment for him, obviously.
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Especially if you come on as a sub and you score the equaliser at Ibrox, you're happy.
All right, well, at the other end of the table, it's been a turbulent week in the history of Hibernian. A 6-2 thrashing at Fir Park, leaving them 4 points adrift at the bottom. And it was followed by the sacking, of course, of Jim Duffy. Well, with a favoured replacement, Paul Sturrock, preferring to remain at McDermott Park, Hibs recently appointed football development manager Billy McNeil was in charge against relegation rivals Aberdeen. And here's David Tanner.
These are tense times for Hibernian chairman Lex Gold. He wanted a new manager in the dugout for today's game, but instead he got an old one, Billy McNeil, back in a managerial hot seat after a seven-year break. It's been a tense week at Aberdeen as well. Stephen Glass, who hit the crossbar there, has decided to sign a pre-contract agreement with Newcastle, much to the annoyance of Alex Miller. Glass, as always, involved yesterday testing recalled goalkeeper Oleg Skaldsson. Miller's Aberdeen are playing with confidence at home at the moment. Miller wants to recreate the mood from the 80s when Pittodrie was seen as a fortress. Well, Aberdeen's defence seems to be impregnable at the moment at home. You can't say the same for Hibernian. All at sea during this game is Aberdeen pushed forward time and time again. And that was so close there from John Ingalls. But Aberdeen finally broke the deadlock. The cross from Stephen Glass, buried by Mike Newell. The former Blackburn and Birmingham City man's first goal in front of his home support. The defence looking sluggish and the goalkeeper couldn't keep that one out. So Aberdeen took that lead into the second half and Newell was involved again, exposing that Hibernian defence. The ball across the face of the goal and no takers. But there was a taker shortly after that as Derek White's free kick landed at the feet of Ian Jess. And Jess made it 2-0. But a defensive mistake again. Sean Dennis mistimed his jump. And that set up World Cup 98 hopeful Jess to score his seventh goal of the season. And just 2 minutes after that, it was 3-0. A good passing move this by Aberdeen. A nice ball through there to Joe Miller. He squeezed it over the goalkeeper and he forced it into the net. Aberdeen 3, Hibernian 0, 59 minutes gone. Joe Miller showing the fight to finish that move off. It was a good day for the Miller family. Wee Joe playing with plenty of confidence. And namesake Alec, his manager, seeing off his former side. And time running out for Hibs, 12 games to go.
We put the ball in certain areas and then hurt Hibs, and that's what we'd set out and worked at all week. I think the important thing is that, I don't like seeing Hibs in the plight they're in because I spent 10 good years there and enjoyed it. But the most important factor is my loyalties are with Aberdeen, and I can't have sentiment because really there's no sentiment in football.
And obviously, in a new manager position, he might have a whole lot of new ideas. He would obviously put his own systems in and his own attitude to the game in force. And, you know, Alec Miller has done a considerable job here in the short time he's been here, and I think that gives indication of what can happen.
Well, the first task is actually morale. I mean, the team are now playing without any confidence themselves, and it's about time they got their heads up. They've got to play for their own professionalism. They've also got to play for this club. And if they don't want to, I want to hear from them.
Well, Craig, interesting. Strong words from Lex Gold. Yeah. Get a grip of yourself, he's saying.
Absolutely, yeah. I think he's right. But the unsettled nature of the place at the moment won't help. But quickly, if they get a manager, they'll be on the right road. I think there are a lot of good players down there. Now, I think if they get themselves together and organised, Hibernian's a big club. And everyone, I think, wants to see Hibernian doing well.
And a man you know well, Alec Miller, doing very well with Aberdeen, and he's got them off and running again, hasn't he?
Absolutely. Well, I knew Alec would do that. And he takes some harsh decisions without any problem. You know, he's left out Comwari, for example, and Dodds and Windass, guys who were established in the team and were going through the motions, apparently, according to Alec's decision. So he's brought in big Newell, and Newell is not letting them down up front.
And what about Ian Jess? Now, has he got an outside chance of making the 22 for France?
Yeah, Ian Jess has a chance because he's a gifted footballer and we're looking for talent like that. But if I take all the recommendations, we'll have two charter aircraft going.
Exactly.
Ian will be on.
It's a nice goal from Joe Miller, isn't it?
Excellent, yeah. Joe in good position there and he follows up in a determined fashion to get it away. And Joe does well. Joe always gives you value when he's playing. I think you realise that. You'll never get less than 90 minutes effort from wee Joe.
But we need Hibs to get it right, because you, as Scotland coach, want a strong Hibs.
Correct.
You want to be able to pick some of those players.
Absolutely.
If they're good enough.
Indeed, Hibs are a good side. And, you know, young guys like Harper, who has been excellent at under-21 level, needs to get some success in the big team and a bit of profile there and a better side, and then we can look towards them being in the big team.
Yes, indeed. All right, Greg. Well, that was the battle at the bottom. Now the clash of the clubs vying for fourth position and a possible place in Europe. St Johnstone held that position going into the match against Kilmarnock. Killy, though, were just a couple of points behind them. Katrina Harvey watched this one, unlike the Saints manager.
It was a battle for fourth place at Rugby Park, and the home side showed in the first minute there's more to Kilmarnock than just pies. This meaty effort from Kevin McGowan just inches over. Killy continued to press forward, Paul Wright spotting fullback Martin Baker on the wing. He takes on the defence, but his shot well blocked by Main. The ball falls to Gus McPherson. A powerful strike, but another tremendous save from the Scotland hopeful. Into the second half, and the Saints finally start venturing towards the Killy goal. Dazovic to O'Neill. O'Boyle, oh dear. He knows he should have done better. Plenty of time and space, but a costly missed kick. But O'Boyle's a feisty character and battles superbly to get the ball from Loughlin. A neat pass to Fizzy Scott, but Colin Meldrum ensuring that effort went flat. Killy brought on substitute Tom Wright after an absence of 6 months through injury, and he very nearly had the dream comeback. A nice head flick to namesake Paul. He returns the favour, great control, but the Saints stopper the main man once again. However, with just seconds of the match remaining, Killy claimed the points in spectacular style. Mark Riley's left-footed volley flying into the top corner. Agony for the Saints, but the Killy troops loving the strike of Riley. Ali Mitchell's corner cleared by Scott, but that's a sensational finish from the Killy midfielder. The scoreboard says it all, and Bobby Williamson's side leapfrogging the Saints into fourth top.
We told the guys to be patient. Didn't really mean that patient to go to the 90th minute. But no, we're delighted with 3 points. It looked at one time we'd have to settle for a point, but as I said, we're delighted to have climbed above St Johnstone.
And what about that strike?
Yes, so very fortunate. It sat up nice for me. And I think after the last game here, where I missed the penalty, I would the boys won. So we're very happy to get the 3 points.
And I'm not surprised at that. Matt Riley's a good player, isn't he, Craig? I mean, I'm not putting everybody in the frame here for France 98, but he's a good striker of a ball, isn't he?
Excellent, yeah. And he doesn't give it away at all. You know, he's a great close-range play. And, of course, there he unleashed one from 22 yards, which was terrific. But nice left-sided player, Matt.
And pleasing for you to see Alan Main in very good form. Some good saves from him. Now, you were saying Neil Sullivan's just ahead of him in the queue, but what about having this guy anywhere near your squad?
Well, obviously, Chairman, my namesake, Mr. Jeff Brown, said you're here to see a goalkeeper yesterday when I went there, and I was there to see an excellent goalkeeper yesterday, because apparently in the last game against Kilmarnock, he had held Kilmarnock at bay himself.
Yeah.
And then again yesterday, tremendous saves. No chance with a goal. But we've got, as you know, we've got Leighton, we've got Gorham, we've got Sullivan, we've got Jonathan Gould in contention. We'll see him today.
Yes.
And obviously,
you're
we've got Alan
in that
Main.
Department. What about Paul Wright? Now, he must be knocking on the door all the time.
Absolutely.
He's so keen to catch you, right? And as this sequence of pictures show, he's a prolific goal scorer.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, we've two B internationals coming up. You know, we've won against Wales, we've won against Norway, and hopefully I'll get a look at Paul. And, you know, if someone emerges from the first B international, someone like Paul Wright, for example, emerges, we can think of him in terms of the full team for the next game, for our second friendly against Finland, or another outing in the B team against Norway. So there's opportunity yet for everyone.
Either way, you're in a good position.
Absolutely,
right?
Yeah.
Great, Craig. Okay. Well, Craig and I are coming to you from Tynecastle this afternoon, where in about, 40 minutes' time, Hearts face Celtic in a match that could well have a significant bearing on the outcome of the championship. All the team news and the rest of the weekend action after this very short break. Hello again. Well, a great atmosphere building up here at Tynecastle. You can probably see Jonathan Gould of Celtic warming up behind me. It's the most crucial match of the season so far. It's Hearts against Celtic. The prize for the winner, a 2-point lead in the race for the title. Well, no such ambitions for Dundee United. They're more concerned with life at the other end of the table. Five games without a win had seen them slip onto the fringes of the relegation battle. Motherwell were the visitors at Tannadice.
Motherwell's lacklustre first half performance was in marked contrast to their superb showing against Hibs last week. They were lucky to be on level terms at the break, or at least lucky to have Stephen Woods on the side. The Motherwell goalkeeper made a number of important saves in this game, that time there from defender Mark Perry. United kept on pushing, and Woods had plenty of work in his hands in this game. Jean-Jacques Missi-Missi starting his first full game for the club, testing him that time. But then Motherwell tried one. Lee McCulloch setting up Willie Falconer. And it was off the line by Malpass. But normal service was soon resumed. And the other goal was soon looking exposed again. Missi-Missi with the cross. Olofsson's header. And Woods just kept it out. The inevitable happened in the middle of the second half. Long ball forward from Malpass, and a mix-up now between Eddie May and his goalkeeper, punished by Shell Olofsson. Dundee United 1, Motherwell 0. It took a long time coming, but United certainly deserved it. A lack of communication at the back there, and Olofsson reacted well. The United players were enjoying themselves now with the thought of spending their first league win bonus since December. And Missi-Missi almost finished in style, but it ended 1-0 at Tannadice.
And that defeat for Motherwell means they're back in second bottom spot in the Bells Premier Division, but with the relegation playoff expected to be scrapped as part of the breakaway deal, it's likely just one side will go down, and on current form, it looks like Hibs, they are now 5 points adrift at the foot. Now, with no playoff place, it's a winner-takes-all situation in the First Division. Neil Henderson now describes the matches involving leaders Dundee and promotion rivals Raith Rovers.
League leaders Dundee took 34 minutes to break down second-bottom Stirling Albion when Brian Irvine's header cannoned off the post and John McGlashan reacted superbly to drive home. This was only McGlashan's second start for the Dark Blues. He was filling in for the injured Jim McAnally, and a sharp finish by the midfielder. John McCormack's side built on the lead 5 minutes before the break. Craig Tully's pass picked out the ever-nippy James Grady, and he found himself with only the goalkeeper to beat. He couldn't do it, but Steve McCormack did. 2-0 Dundee. A well-worked goal in this First Division match, and a clear message from the former Albion man to his new set of admirers. The game should have been killed off just before the interval. Craig Tully provided the dagger for Ian Anderson, but he didn't spill any blood. The shortest stay in the park award of the season goes to Stirling substitute Stuart McLaren, who decided to give Dundee captain Barry Smith an over-energetic bear hug, and ref Willie Young in turn gave him a red card. McLaren walks off the field just 2.5 minutes after coming on. Stirling Albion came close to scoring in the middle of the second half. Bain hit the shot, but Fleming was on the line. But from another corner, Kevin Drinkle's men did pull a goal back. Gavin Price rising powerfully to bury the corner. Stirling 1, Dundee 2. John Gibson's corner and Price, the former St Johnstone and Den Haag striker, met it well. But just as the fourth bank home support began to dream of comebacks, Dundee killed off the game thanks to James Grady, 1-1 with goalie McGowan, and the striker comes out the winner. So did Dundee, 3-1, and the league leaders maintain their unbeaten away record for the season, if only they were as good at Dens Park. Raith Rovers did their promotion chances no harm at all when they beat Falkirk during the week. Next in their way, a Partick Thistle side who had goalkeeper Kenny Arthur to thank for keeping them in the game in the first half, firstly with that save from Scott Thompson. The goalkeeper could do nothing but watch as his side were reduced to 10 men after a Raith Rovers attack was ended by Keith Wright going down inside the box. That earned the Kakati side a penalty kick, and it was Thistle youngster Kevin Gocken who was shown the red card for that soft challenge on Keith Wright. So the penalty going Raith Rovers' way, and Thistle fans dismayed at losing one of their players. The spot kick responsibility fell to Danny Lennon, but Kenny Arthur, steering the sun, pulled down the shutters. Some would say that justice was done after that save. A moment of hope for Thistle, which was forgotten about when Raith Rovers took the lead a couple of minutes later on the hour mark. Paul Hartley's cross side-footed home by Dargo. 60 seconds after that, it could so easily have been 2-0. Scott Thompson with the chance, and Kenny Arthur reacted sharply. Despite the best efforts of Thistle's number one, Raith Rovers soon hit number two. Billy McDonald couldn't clear his lines after he made the tackle, and Keith Wright pushed the ball towards John Miller, and he didn't hesitate. 2-0 Rovers, 69 minutes gone. Miller, whose goals knocked Hibs out of the 10th Scottish Cup, chose the right type of finish. Near the end of the match, Raith Rovers could have extended the lead. The pass into the path of Danny Lennon, but a great save from Arthur. Thistle were given a chance to make the scoreline look more respectable in the final minutes. Fotheringham fouled Loughlin, and ref Elmsley awarded a penalty kick. But Guido van de Kamp diving to save, and in the end, 2-0 Rovers.
Yes, and that victory for Raith Rovers lifts them above Falkirk into second place. But Jimmy Nicholls' side are still five behind leaders Dundee, who are on 47 points. Only 1 point separates the bottom four, with Morton right at the basement. Well, Craig Brown's with me, as you'll have gathered this afternoon. And Craig, you're just back from Miami, and you saw Brazil in action. And the big guns were all there, bar who? Ronaldo and Dunga?
Ronaldo, Dunga, yes. They had their full team. They're playing a lot of friendlies, Brazil. They're determined to get it right. You know, they want to, you know, retain this World Cup. You know, it was a long spell when they didn't win the World Cup. Now, that was quite interesting, and that's encouraging for us.
Yeah.
Because I think the man that won it for them, of course, was the manager, Carlos Alberto Pereira.
Sure.
That was a chance there for Romario.
Here we are. This is Brazil against Jamaica.
Yeah, just watch the elbow here. Go, there it is. No attempt to play the ball, and big Junior Baiano was sent off, I think.
And you expect Junior Baiano to face us? I mean, he'll
Yeah. I think he's one of the key players at the back. You see him there, number three. He certainly put the elbow in the opponent's face, and, I mean, it's quite horrific.
And that was it, but it was 0-0. Yeah. But Romario, that shot, the shot he had there we saw saved, he looks in form.
Oh, he is in form. Romario, magnificent.
Yeah.
And, you know, Edmundo up front with him looked great. Zinho, they've got so many alternatives. It's quite frightening.
And you then left, Craig, and I believe Brazil played Guatemala.
Yeah.
And we can see this here now. Well, this is a controversial end to this one. There's Guatemala on the attack, and Taffarel, we remember well, he played for Brazil.
Yeah, Taffarel played in the game I saw, and I think he might just play against us, although he's considered to be on the wrong side of 30, you know, and that's all right for a goalkeeper.
There's a goal disallowed.
Well, Edmundo's there in good position. I think it looked just offside, and he was happy with it, but obviously it was chopped off.
Edmundo, he's gone to Fiorentina, hasn't he?
And
there's Zagallo out protesting. And then, of course, well, there's Romario. Do you think there's a penalty?
Well, it looked like it. I've got to say from here, and it's difficult often from the TV screen, but it certainly looked like a penalty. I don't know why they're complaining.
They are complaining. Look at this for a wicked penalty kick. If ever there's a perfect penalty, that's it.
That's Romario for you. You know, he's inch perfect in most of his passes, and there's a penalty.
Absolutely. And then in the 94th minute, there we are, yeah, the equaliser for Guatemala.
I see that. I'm disappointed that that's been shown, because I saw they had no one at the back post, and I was noting that. And a corner against, they don't defend it. Now, having lost that goal, maybe Zagallo will change his defensive organisation.
Because they paid the price there.
Well, they did, yeah.
Well, Craig, you'll be interested in this. My colleague Neil Henderson was over in Marrakesh last week, and there's our other opponents in the group, Morocco. Now, they played Niger. And that was Bassier of Deportivo La Coruña scoring. And here's Chipo from Porto. They've got good players, Craig.
Yeah, the players all come from top clubs, so we can't underestimate Morocco. They're reckoned to be the best team in Africa. And certainly that's not Casablanca, as you said, that's Marrakesh. But they're a very, very lively side. And at home, they're used to playing with 80,000 there.
Yeah, it's Badger with a penalty. In various departments, they're strong. And you know that anyway.
Yeah, well, my colleague Frank Coulston was overseeing them. And they played Angola recently. And Frank saw the game and came back with a very, very worrying report. Saying how skillful they were, how quick they were.
But we've got two games to see them before we play them, so yeah, we'll get a better chance to look at them.
You'll know all about them.
Yeah.
Sure. OK, well, a few of the players expected to feature in Craig's World Cup squad will be on show right here at Tynecastle today. Some of them are out there. Paul Cooney can now tell us exactly who to look out for. He's down in the tunnel area with the full team lineups. Paul?
Yeah, Jim, it is big news for Hearts fans and also for Craig Brown, because someone who wasn't quoted for today, David Weir, is fit and will play. A big surprise for Hearts. For Celtic, no problems, the same as the team that met Aberdeen in midweek. So the Hearts lineup then: Roddy McKenzie, as we told you earlier, in goal. Gary Locke and Gary Naismith. David Weir, the surprise, Dave McPherson and Paul Ritchie. Neil McCann, Stevie Fulton, Stefan Adam, the man in form, Colin Cameron, and Stefano Salvatore. On the bench, Jim Hamilton, Hosi Katongo and Thomas Flogel. Celtic, no changes from that Aberdeen lineup. Jonathan Gould, number one. Enrico Annone, Stefan Mahe. Jackie McNamara is fit and plays. Mark Reaper, he scored already this season against Hearts. Number five, Alan Stubbs wears six. Henrik Larsson, Craig Burley, Harold Brattback, number nine. Paul Lambert is 10, Morten Veghorst, 11. And on the bench for Celtic, the men who want to be in France with Craig Brown, Darren Jackson and Simon Donnelly. And also there is David Hannah. So those are the lineups here. But the big news is that David Weir is fit and he will play for Hearts in this huge crunch match this afternoon.
Thanks, Paul. And Craig, that's interesting news because you want to see David Weir in action.
Absolutely. And David, every time I've seen him this season, he's played exceptionally well. In fact, in a couple of occasions, he's been man of the match. So I'm delighted. And you know, he had a very, very good game for us against France when we played in St Etienne recently. So David's one certainly that I've got to look at very, very carefully.
And when we look at the team again, obviously, well, disappointed. Well, there is David Weir. He's out there live here at Tynecastle just warming up. And in the goalkeeping area, there's no Gilles Rousset, and Roddy McKenzie comes in. And you think this fella's got a future?
Yeah, I do. We've had him in the youth setup, and Alan Hodgkinson has worked with him in some of the goalkeeping training sessions. He's a very fine young goalkeeper. Of course, I've always thought that Gilles Rousset was one of the key players here, and I still do. And the Hearts will certainly miss him because of his experience. But the youngster, I'm sure, won't let them down. He's a fine goalkeeper and one that we're looking at for the future under 21 and national teams.
All right, Craig. Now, from Celtic's point of view, there is McKenzie. And he, obviously, when he, if he's recorded this and he watches it tonight, he'll be pleased to hear what you just said about him. I'm quite sure, Craig. But he could be in for a busy afternoon. And when you look at the Celtic lineup, Brattback, the Norwegian, continues to hold his place, and of course that means that you're denied a look at Simon Donnelly, who again is on the bench. But Brattback's a good player, isn't he?
He is a good player, yeah. His movement is tremendous, and I think when I was looking at him for the first time in the Old Firm game, and Charlie Nicholas was making the point, and no one knows more about it than Charlie, playing up front, Charlie said his movement is tremendous, and that caught my eye, and he certainly does well. He hasn't scored the goals that perhaps he would have hoped, but he's been desperately unlucky, and he's a good player. Larsson, a good player, of course, and that's keeping Jackson and Donnelly out of the starting lineup.
But who should go to France 98, I'm quite sure.
Well,
Jackson and Donnelly?
I would think so. They're very much in contention. They're in the squad, let's put it that way, and they'll have to drop out to go out.
I'm going to be pushing you all afternoon.
You are indeed, hey?
OK, the latest from Tynecastle, and a look at the recent form of both sides, Hearts and Celtic, in just a couple of minutes from now. Welcome back to Tynecastle. Let's hear from Paul Cooney now, who's with Murdo McLeod.
Thank you.
Murdo, we've had the team so clearly, no problems for you?
No problems at all. Jackie and Henrik are both fit after the Aberdeen game, and we're delighted they're in the starting lineup.
How did you feel as you prepared yesterday and you heard the Rangers scoreline against Dunfermline?
Well, obviously that gives both sides a lift today, because they know if a victory gets them top on their own. But again, we'll always look after ourselves.
David Weir in for Hearts, a real boost for them. Are you worried about the fact that he's playing?
Well, he's very influential for them, but they've left out Flogel up front, so that's bringing in a defender for a forward, so we might have to reshape at the back.
What do you and Vim say to the players? Because consistency has been the problem for Celtic. You've played some lovely flowing football, but sometimes you let yourselves down.
Well, I think some of the games that we're expected to win, we've dropped points at, but the most important games are the so-called bigger games. We seem to be up for it better, like the games against Hearts here before and the game at Celtic Park. We won both of them.
You've been over this course, of course, as a Celtic player. So how do you feel now in management? Does it remind you of the years when there was a real race for the championship?
Yeah, it's always going to be tight, but now with only 13 games left for ourselves, we know that a victory today could set us on the way.
So who are you looking to this afternoon? Craig Burley has been a great signing for you and Wim Jansen.
Yeah, he scored a lot of important goals, but I think the whole side's got to play well today. You can't ask for two or three just to go and play well, and the rest just to be mediocre. The rest have got to stick in.
Good conditions out there, Murdo?
Yes, good. Just a wee bit windy, but apart from the wind, the surface is magnificent.
All the best this afternoon.
Thank you very much.
Murdo McLeod with Paul. Well, after back-to-back defeats at the hands of the Old Firm just before Christmas, many reckoned Hearts' title challenge would fizzle out, but an unbeaten start to 1998 has kept them hot on the heels of the Big Two. There are some great strikes there, and Craig, really, they're spread right across the team, aren't they? So many players are capable of scoring goals for Hearts, which is so good for Jim Jefferies.
Yeah, I think that's the strength of Hearts. The goals can come from anywhere, and in fact, looking at our team today, it strikes me as if they'll play one up only, and that could be Adam, and he'll get quick support from Cameron and McCann. But you see there, Jim Hamilton, the leading scorers on the bench, what a substitute to have.
Absolutely.
And Quatongo as well, Flogo. Both teams actually have very positive benches, which is the only defender, out-and-out defender on the bench is David Hanna. So
and Colin Cameron, an attacking midfielder, Craig, who
absolutely.
Obviously I know you're a fan of his.
Very much so.
There he is out in the pitch at the moment.
For my money, he's the key man here. When he plays, they play. And he's an outstanding midfield player who supports the front brilliantly. And we'll certainly have him at least in the B team in the next game. And then, of course, the second B team, B game against Norway, is here at Tynecastle. So one or two of the Hearts boys will be involved.
So on his home patch here,
absolutely.
If he does turn it on and impress you, he could end up at the World Cup finals.
He could indeed, yeah. We're well off in the midfield, I've got to emphasise that. But Cameron is one of the guys that's pushing very hard indeed. And, you know, when you add, as you've already done, Ian Jess and people like that,
yeah.
We've got the Billy McKinleys, the Scott Gimmels, all on the fringe of this midfield. So I'll be very interested in
Cameron. And Neil McCann wants to impress here too,
absolutely.
And he knows that you're sitting watching this, and he's a good player, isn't
yeah,
he?
Yeah, absolutely. McCann, excellent. He's got to turn of pace from a standing position. Excellent left foot, good delivery. And if he could just be consistent. Unfortunately, when I've seen him against Celtic, he's not done it too well in the past.
Now, yeah.
Here's a chance for him. And, you know, I've got the door open for someone, a wide player like that with penetration, would be great in our squad.
Excellent, Craig. Okay. Well, Celtic ended the year with a shock defeat at McDermott Park, but they bounced back in style. Victory in the new year Old Firm clash gave them the best possible start to 1998 and the confidence to put together a decent run of results. Celtic doing well, as you saw there. Well, let's go back down to the tunnel. David Weir is playing this afternoon for Hearts. Something of a surprise. He's with Paul Cooney.
Well, David, yes, you've surprised everybody. How did you manage to come back so quickly when you had surgery just a week past Tuesday?
Well, I've trained the last couple of days and I've not had any problems with it, so we had a wee conversation with the manager and we decided, you know, I wasn't having any pain from it, so we'd just go for it.
What was the problem?
I just had a little bit of bone removed from my leg, just it was connecting to the tibia and the fibula, so it was restricting my movement that way, but it's been cleared up, so I've had no problems.
You kept it under wraps for the last day or two, but it must be a big boost for your teammates for such an important game with Celtic.
Well, I hope so, you know, I hope it can help us to go on and get a result here. It's a very important day for us.
What's the secret of the team this season and the way that you're gelling?
I think we just work hard, you know, there's no superstars and everybody works for each other and we're all here for the one aim.
The problem has been, of course, unable to beat Celtic or Rangers so far. How do you tackle it today?
Just tackle it as I tackle every other game. You know, we go out to win every game, no matter who it's against, so we'll just approach it in our usual way.
Craig Brown was delighted to hear. He's upstairs with Jim White here at Tynecastle watching, and I know that you'd love to be in France in the summer.
Oh, definitely, yeah. That's the goal, I think, for every Scottish-born player this season. You know, everybody's shooting for that, so it'd be great to be involved in that.
Jim was asking for goals yesterday for either side. We'd be the same today. Do you think we're going to see a good game here with this huge audience?
I'd like to think so. You know, it's two attacking teams with a lot of good players on show, so hopefully we won't disappoint the fans.
Colin Cameron is just one of the players in form, isn't he?
That's right. He got a couple of goals last week, so I'm sure he's settled for that again today.
David, I'm sure everybody, though, is glad to see you back so soon. Well done.
Thanks very much.
David, we are quite happy, obviously, that he's playing this afternoon. Well, if you're getting excited sitting watching on television, just think of the fans who will actually be right here at Tynecastle. An anxious afternoon ahead for them. David Tanner's been among some of the supporters as they arrived at the ground.
Looking forward to it all week. It's going to be a close game. Obviously, there's a lot at stake, so I think it's going to be difficult to call. I think this could be a Hearts' chance this season, I think. Just got this feeling today that they're going to do well.
Well, it'll be like winning the league if we win the day, hopefully.
Really, you're as confident as that? What about you?
It's only one-way traffic today. 3-1 victory for the boys.
Hearts have been playing some good stuff, though. You must be slightly worried that they could create something.
They haven't got the bottle for it. Well, they've always been the same. Just one of these things. Sorry.
You've just bought your match programme there. How confident are you that's going to be one to keep a souvenir?
Well, that's for my grandbairn. Eh? I go back to 1956 when we won the Scottish Cup and it was against Celtic. We're going to win today.
Very confident prediction, then it wandered off. Right, time for another quick break. Hearts against Celtic live coming your way in just a few minutes from now. Hello again. Well, we're just waiting for the teams to emerge right here at Tynecastle. Hearts Celtic live. It is a big, big match indeed, a massive match. Craig Brown and I were told during that break, the commercial break, a bit of interesting news, surprising news to say the least, that Dundee manager John McCormack has been sacked today. And Craig, of course, very strange that, because Dundee are sitting top of the First Division.
Yeah, it's surprising to me. I mean, when any manager's sacked, I feel very upset about it. Jim Duffy last week, now John McCormack. But when you're top of the league, it's the last thing you expect. And it's a major surprise, certainly to me.
Yes, indeed. Well, John McCormack sacked. Manager of Dundee has been sacked this afternoon. Well, the team's just about to come out. Craig, Hearts Celtic, where is this game, the big question, where is it going to be won and lost today?
Well, I think it'll be won and lost in front of goal, because the team that takes the half chance will win the game. Because I do think the Hearts are very solid defensively. Celtic equally solid. So if you can get the half chance and take it, one goal might do it.
And whoever gets off to a better start may have the best of this match. Does that necessarily work?
No, Celtic got away to a very poor start against Aberdeen and came back strongly and played exceptionally well. So, you know, Celtic can recover. I think Hearts can as well. And I just would hope that it will be a good sporting game. Great entertainment is, I think, assured. And I'm looking forward to it.
And what about Craig Burley? You're asked this constantly, I know. He's playing so well for Celtic in the centre of midfield. Will you revert to that position for him should he make it to France 98?
Well, Jim, it gives us a great option. You know, and the more versatility in Craig and other players, the better. He played centre-half for us against Belarus. He played brilliantly. He's done well down the right side. He's doing exceptionally well for Celtic in there. And incidentally, played for Chelsea in central midfield. We've had him there in the national team, I think before Celtic had him. We played him against Sweden at Ibrox. So I know all about Craig, and he's a wonderful guy in the squad because of his versatility. We'll wait till we see how things are near the time, then decide whether he's there or in the wide position or centre-half or whatever.
And that wide position, you could even have a man like Jackie McNamara who will be playing out there this afternoon. And I know that you're increasingly impressed by this youngster.
Absolutely. Well, Jackie, I thought, was the man of the match against Aberdeen in Celtic's last game, and he was playing down that side. He's protected, of course, or he was, with Anoni playing wider to defend the game against Aberdeen, so it meant that he could go forward with Gay Abandon. Now, when he's the only player in the wide area on the side, it's much more difficult. Now, Burley does that well, so does Jackie. So, you know, Craig Burley, Jackie McNamara, you pay your money, and at the time, we'll decide, but it'll have to be the balance of the team. You know, we could say, yeah, we've got other alternatives from the central midfield position, so we'll use Craig in a wide area. The one thing I'll say, Jim, is he will play anywhere he's asked. He's a brilliant professional.
Great professional.
Yeah.
Let me put the Scotland coach on the spot. Who's going to win this afternoon?
Well, I usually go for the draw, and this is no exception. I think we'll have three teams in the same points at the end of the day. That's a diplomatic answer.
All right, Craig, you can hear the roar. The teams are coming out. Let's join summariser Charlie Nicholas and commentator Jay McNee.
Well, the rebuilt Tynecastle is bursting at the seams and bursting with anticipation. Hearts and Celtic have been the pretenders. Now they have the chance to become kings. The message is simple this afternoon: win the game, go clear at the top of the league. So a huge ovation for both sides. And as you can see, capacity these days, 18,000. And this match has been sold out for days. So let's have another look at the team lineups for this afternoon. First of all, Hearts, they show one change after beating Dundee United here last week. David Weir, as we heard, is back in defence, and in a tactical switch, Thomas Flogel is on the bench. And now Celtic, well, with Jackie McNamara and Henrik Larsson passing their fitness test, it's the same starting 11 who fought back to beat Aberdeen 3-1 at Celtic Park last Monday night. Celtic's away record had been poor until they went to Tannadice a couple of weeks ago. They fought back in that one as well, but this is a real test for the championship aspirations this afternoon. And the referee this afternoon, Bobby Tate from East Kilbride, he was in charge for the December meeting of these clubs at Celtic Park, which Celtic won by 1-0. He also took charge of the Edinburgh Derby here at New Year, the 2-2 draw between Hearts and Hibs. Big afternoon for Ronnie McKenzie, 22 years of age. Well, he's had two shutouts in the two games. He's been standing in for Gilles Rousset. But last week, he struggled a bit with the high ball against Dundee United. If Celtic have done their homework, they might be trying from set pieces to get Alan Stubbs forward and Mark Reaper to put him under pressure. And a welcome return for David Weir. It said in the match programme today he would start light training tomorrow, but he's back this afternoon. A real surprise from Jim Jeffries. The Celtic huddle now breaks up. Just seconds away now from kick-off, and alongside me as ever is Charlie Nicholas.
Good afternoon, Jerry. Good afternoon to everyone. It's a very special day, obviously, for someone to go clear. You typically think that Celtic's reliable defence will be looking forward to this challenge today. Hearts have got to eventually take something from the Old Firm. This is the day that they might just do it.
Well, what an atmosphere inside this famous ground. The final check by the referee with his assistants. And away we go in this hugely important match. Hearts have been in excellent form recently. They're unbeaten in their last six matches, since losing 5-2 to Rangers here on the 20th of December. In fact, they've had one defeat in eight league games. And the previous defeat came at the hands of Celtic. And Hearts must be fed up listening to the fact that they've failed to beat the Old Firm in four outings this season. They have the chance to put that right this afternoon. So Craig Burley there, who's been so influential for Celtic and has weighed in with 11 goals so far, a magnificent record from the midfield. But as we heard earlier in the programme, a good spread of goals coming from Hearts. And that will certainly make it difficult for the Celtic defenders this afternoon. Just wondering where to mark down the danger areas. And there's another player who's having a fine season, the former Celtic player Steve Fulton, who takes the throw-in. Challenges again there.
both teams have made little tactical changes. They thought they might have went a back three at halves, but they've actually went a solid four. But in combating that, Brad Back has immediately went on the left side and Larson more central, so a lot of tactical stuff going on early on. It'll be 10 minutes or so before they'll probably settle down.
McCann gets away from Anoni. Anoni's back there, but the challenge to get in before that from Morten Wieghorst. That's a free kick. Two Hearts, about 30 yards from goal. Well, Enrico Anoni will be paying attention to this man this afternoon, but he slipped away from him. And it was Morten Wieghorst who made the challenge there. So an early opportunity for Hearts to test Jonathan Gold. 18 shutouts he's had this season, 11 of them in the championship race. This is Cameron. They just hesitated a little bit there, Hearts, but still they have it. That's through from Fulton. It's Cameron! And Jonathan Gold called to early action with just over 2 minutes showing on the clock here at Tynecastle. It didn't look the smartest of free kicks, and then a nice little ball through here from Fulton. And then Cameron trying to curl it away around the goalkeeper, who responded well.
It's a great effort. It's worth the try early on, and they're asking questions of Celtic already.
And then comes the corner kick. But, Celtic scrambling away there under a bit of pressure from David Weir. And a challenge goes in there from Stefano Salvatore. Free kick now to Celtic. No doubt about that one. Got Alan Stubbs crashing to the ground. Celtic player now just getting back to his feet. So an early threat there from the set piece by Hearts. And now we'll see how Celtic respond. Split shot now to Stefan Mahi. Long one by Stubbs. So Harold Blackback still looking for his first championship goal. He scored in the Scottish Cup a couple of weeks back. But taking a little bit of time to settle, just one goal in 8 games. And Celtic will be looking for more. Another outlay of some £2 million. It's better play now by Celtic. This is Larson. Well challenged though by Locke. The game going along at a cracking pace, as you would expect. It's McCann. Salvatore. Fulton. Trying to switch the play away to the far side. Good follow-up play there by Gary Locke. He was pushed more forward in the second half against Dundee United last week. Started off at right back, but a tactical switch by Jim Jeffries late in the game. He was pushed forward, and he was effective. Hard to believe the likes of Gary Locke was in the youth team, the BP Cup-winning team in 1993. And now he's the club captain here at Tynecastle. So many good youngsters breaking through. Meanwhile, it's Anoni under pressure from McCann. He does just enough. This is Jackie McNamara. So they want to get him forward at every opportunity. Larson, good ball now through for Anoni. The flag is up though as Burnley move forward.
Good experienced player from McPherson. His timing was excellent. You see him, he reads the situation, steps up. Good experience from Big Dave. A good build-up from Celtic. Celtic have got to try and get the pace at a level that suits them. So far it's Hearts who have upped the pressure and the pace. And that will suit Hearts to get at Celtic quickly. Celtic need to get McNamara and Burley in particular on the ball, and Lambert to try and control the pace of the match.
So that's out for the throw-in. Two Hearts in the line with the Celtic penalty area. There has been just one goal this game here between these clubs in the 23 years of the Premier Division, so I think we can expect goals this afternoon. And here's a real threat coming forward again. It's Cameron, and he's well challenged there by Paul Lambert. Corner to Hearts. Well, that goal this match I was referring to came back in season 89-90. So 37 games, one goalless match. And now Jonathan Gould faces some pressure here along with his defenders. Keeper commits himself, there's no real challenge to him. He gathered that one confidently. It's followed by Locke. Well, Celtic's midfield and defenders tended to leave that to one another, and Hearts almost cashed in. Now they have the throw-in. forward by Weir. Looking for McCann, and the referee indicates a bit of pushing by Enrico Annone. Free kick now to Hearts. Celtic player doesn't agree. It's floating over the ball with Locke. David McPherson has pushed forward into the area. Weir's up there also, so plenty of aerial threat. Looks out now for Larsson. The early ball followed by him. And, certainly Locke seemed to impede Brackback as he was trying to run on to that through ball. But referee allows play to go on. Headed down by Mahe, but McPherson's here, he's calling for the goalkeeper. Well, Roddy McKenzie decided to stay in his line, and you can see there's a real fallout between the two Hearts players there.
Well, someone's got to make a decision. Dave's the most experienced. He should really make a decision. He's waiting a keeper. He doesn't want to take the gamble.
Well, perhaps if McPherson had done that in the cup final for Rangers a few years ago, it might have been a different story against Dundee United, but on that occasion he whacked the ball out of play. And it's a corner to Celtic. The keeper's under pressure here, he's missed it! Hearts are trying desperately to scramble it away. And Hearts indeed very fortunate to survive that. It's now behind for the goal kick. Well, I mentioned just before kick-off that Roddy McKenzie had struggled last week against United with the high ball. They completely lost this one. It was almost in, they just cleared off the line by Salvatore and then scrambled away.
Well, just 10 seconds before it, he could make a decision, he didn't want to take a gamble. This time the pressure tells on him, he couldn't handle the situation. Richie can't do anything and Salvatore saved the day. A bit of nerves for young McKenzie at the start of this match.
Well, he's 6 foot tall, Roddy McKenzie, and he really should have done better there. So Celtic will no doubt want to pressure him as much as possible, but at the other end it's Cameron applying some pressure for Hearts. Well, Hearts fans are claiming he was impeded, but again the referee waves play on. It's Gould sending it forward. It's headed away by Salvatore, picked up now by Stephen Mahe for Celtic. Salvatore again for Hearts, clipping it through, looking there for Stephen Adam. But a good covering play by Paul Lambert. This is Locke, looking for Adam. Quickly closed down there though. And Reaper and Stubbs between them get it away, rather fortunately in the end, and possession is gifted now to young Gary Naismith, but it's all a bit untidy at the moment, the nerves are showing on both sides. This is Cameron, oh, lovely touch on now to Stephen Adam, he needs some support here. Well, he tried to cut it back to Cameron, there weren't many options open to him. But certainly in these early stages, Colin Cameron is looking very much the part for Hearts. Jackie McNamara did enough there to cause Naismith a problem. Slid off by Brackback. Now it's Annone trying to get forward. That's a corner now to Celtic. The challenge going in from Neil McCann.
I think Annone's got a problem with his left knee there, Jerry. I think he might just have lost his balance and he's maybe just overstretched. That could be a hard one. It's not often you see this guy lying down. See him there just getting his weight on his knee. It's a nasty one.
So with just 10 minutes gone here, a real problem for Celtic. Let's hope for their sake that Annone can continue. But on the bench this afternoon are Darren Jackson, Simon Donnelly and David Hannah. So there is defensive cover in the shape of David Hannah. But Celtic will not want to lose Annone. So we're keeping a close eye on Neil McCann. But on that occasion, it was McCann who was backtracking to keep up with the Celtic defender. So slow treatment goes on, but this is a sore one for the Celtic player. You can see the contact there. But as we watch the replay, he's been helped back to his feet.
Usually give you a couple of minutes to see if it just wears its way off, but not moving too well.
So can Celtic capitalise from the corner kick? Well, and Stubbs is well forward. It's Jackie McNamara to take it. Right across goal, but the referee has intervened. Martin Vikhorst got the ball into the net, but the whistle went immediately from Bobby Tate. Referee indicating perhaps the use of an arm there.
Yeah.
It was Jackie McNamara that swung it in, and the referee indicated there that Vikhorst had used his arm to control the ball.
He did. I mean, he initially takes in the thigh, but I mean, the position of Bobby Tate was a good one. And his control, he gets the break, but his control just lets him down. It just touches his arm. Obviously, the referee's in a good position to call it.
Celtic breaking forward again, looking to like their side in these early stages. That's Mahi. Down he goes, and the referee again reacts with an apology there from Gary Locke for his challenge. So a free kick to Celtic, another opportunity now to put Roddy McKenzie under pressure with the high ball. This will be a real test of metal for the young goalkeeper. There's Holborn, signed just last year from Stennis Muir. It's a big, big day for him. He'll want to settle as quickly as possible. It's Mahi who swings it in. And it all comes to nothing in the end. Harold Brackback there failing to get any power in his effort.
Well, it is a half chance. You're straight, you've got to be alert for these things. I mean, it's hanging up and it's difficult to put power in it. But he doesn't make any decision, he doesn't ask any questions of anyone. It's a half chance, you've just got to knock into the area. But again, Celtic are testing hearts at every set piece.
It's Celtic's ball. Anoni waits no time, but probably gives it away to Naismith. Challenge it again, though, Anoni. That's Celtic's ball. Forward now for Larson. We can just need to calm it down a little bit. Well, Celtic took a 2-0 lead here on their last visit back in October 18 with Reaper and Larson scoring. Cameron got one back for Hearts, and it's Cameron pushing forward here again.
He's got a nice roll today, free roll. McCann stayed on the left side, and he's got the freedom to go and support Adam when he can. And that's when he's at his best, that's the strongest side of his game. So there'll be spaces today for Cameron.
Forward now by Anoni. Positive throw there, looking for Jackie McNamara, and Ritchie was a bit of trouble there. Still it's McNamara, doing well to get in the cross. Away by McPherson, McCann gets a touch forward. Comes Stubbs out for Celtic. He controlled that well. This is Stephen Mahi. He barely passed by him. Vikhorst. For a final ball up. So the initial build-up looked promising from Celtic. Martin Vikhorst there has weighed in with six goals this season from midfield. He'll celebrate his 27th birthday later this month. There's such anticipation in this stadium this season. It's been 36 long years since Hearts won a trophy. He's rolling them on, but it's Celtic breaking again. It's Henrik Larsson swinging in the early ball. In comes Stephen Mahi, wants a touch on it. And that allowed Hearts to regroup. And that's come defending by Paul Ritchie. It's a long ball from McKenzie. Picked up now by Mahi. Followed by Stubbs. For Henrik Larsson, but asking just a bit too much of him. Well, the flag stayed down there as Henrik Larsson pushed forward.
Early thoughts of Celtic, because in that position, the inside left position in behind, Weir and McPherson get caught a bit too close. They send it into that space for the pace of Larsson, who does that run particularly well, and as I mentioned earlier, the Brackback has stayed mainly on the left side to combat maybe David Weir getting forward.
Now by Ritchie, looking for Adam. He's challenged here by Reaper. Cameron tried to slip that one past Lambert. Well, good ball there by Brattbeck. Burnley returns it to him. He's kept that one going down the left-hand side. Brattbeck sends it in. Larson's there. That was excellent play initially by Harold Brattbeck. Played the ball through to Burnley, took the return then, got in the cross for Henrik Larsson. Now it's Mahi. The long ball forward. He'll just be a little bit concerned about some of the defending from his team so far. This is Burnley for Celtic. Now Ritchie powers in well there for Hearts. And the referee, as Estepton, is handball there. Free kick to Hearts. Once again, David Weir moves forward. Well, he was looking for the ball to be delivered a bit earlier. It's Fulton over it. William McPherson, meanwhile, has got away to the far side of the area. Looks aim now in his direction. He gets a touch on it. It's out now for Gary Locke. And that was Ritchie going across to provide the cover. He clips it through, looking for Larsson. Slipped there by Brattbeck. Someone needs to get the ball on the ground here. In fact, the high boot was raised and it's a free kick to Celtic. Both sides are still to settle. The referee box is retaken. Bobby Tate just trying to calm things down a bit. He'll be at open view for Stennis Muir against Brecon next week. They trust it a bit quieter there. Meanwhile, the free kick to Celtic, driven in. Well, certainly, Alan Stubbs can crack them. He's got a couple of goals already this season. Plenty of power in it, but he's never going to trouble Roddy McKenzie. Strength there to hold off the challenge, and he's also won the free kick against Mark Reaper. He's quickly taken out to Salvatore. Good one from him though. And Alan Stubbs just ducked there and let that one run behind for the goal kick. The Billy Hearts will have to do better from such opportunities. Well, Celtic certainly have a decent record here at Tynecastle. Since the Premier Division started, they've won 20, lost just 10. 7 have been drawn, so it's not a place that holds any great feels for them, and certainly not in recent seasons. There's Jackie McNamara now, and taken out of the play there by Salvatore, who's been called over by the referee. So 20 minutes gone here. And a lot of warning there. The final Salvatore, you'll have to be careful. Foul there on Jackie McNamara as he a threat to break forward. Well, Reaper has gone forward for this one. He scored here last time. His first goal for Celtic. Through now by Lambert. Challenge there. And by Fulton. And Martin Vikos looking a little angry. Free kick to Celtic in a line with the penalty area. Opportunity here. Reaper has remained forward. Stubbs is up there as well. It's played into the near post. Locke got a touch on that one. Salvatore climbs. Locke's got it away only as far as Anone. He's going to try one here. That was a good effort that was blocked there by Naismith. Now it's Larson, and Naismith still feeling the effects of blocking that shot. Here he is now. And certainly, I know he cracked that one with great power. Celtic attempting to keep the pressure on here through Jackie McNamara. Good play by McNamara. Burnley sends it across. That spins high behind. Paul Ritchie it was who made the challenge. Corner to Celtic. They're certainly looking the livelier side. The side more likely to score. So it's McNamara who comes across this near side. Well, McPherson and Stubbs there almost wrestling inside the area as a corner kick was taken. Let's get it away again though.
I have to think Dave McPherson will need to be very careful there. He's actually not paying attention to the ball. He's just trying to get his hands on Stubbs.
That's laid off by Larson. And it's another corner to Celtic. McNamara's attempted cross coming off Gary Naismith. The pressure remains on this Hearts defence. Stubbs is still well forward. You can see McPherson's there with him. Cameron's gone back to help out. Mara swings it in. It's Fulton who got the touch. It's still not cleared up. Off the base of the post. Stubbs can't quite believe it. The first time effort from Alan Stubbs. I think it deflected, in fact, off the defender. Onto the post.
It's a great effort for a big defender. Plays in that area. Gets a little break, but that's a right in the luck.
Another corner to Celtic again, it's McNamara who swings it in. This is Locke trying to get away, Burnley gets the touch. High one now from McNamara, the keeper's committed himself, he's lost it again under pressure. McKenzie's trying to get back, here it's Larson! It's another corner. And it's the Celtic fans who are roaring on their team here. They lost, they've gone for the ball initially again. With the high one. On it, and then he was no man's land, but now the pressure has been removed by a poor corner. So a sigh of relief from Roddy McKenzie and his defenders, but the Celtic fans are well pleased by what they're seeing from their team.
Yeah, you would think after 10 minutes the play has calmed down and Celtic have got better movement so far in midfield. Burley's been clever, he's runs forward, and those set piece, the set pieces are putting pressure constantly on the Hearts back lot, and they're just getting away with it at the moment.
Just beyond Larson. This is Fulton.
Really take your time and make the final pass count in that situation. You just rushed it a bit too much.
That's high in the air from Stubbs. And Stubbs has already had a couple of efforts at goal. Too far away from a free kick, and another one, which was deflected onto the post, just to beat the goalkeeper, to let him off the defender. So Hearts having weathered a particular storm, will try to apply some pressure on Celtic now, and that's Cameron just keeping that ball in play. Weir sends it in, but it's an easy one for Jonathan Gould. That's a very good kick out, straight to Naismith. Salvatore's there as well, it's headed clear by Anoni. Another touch from Salvatore, this is Steve Fulton, he's got McCann with him. I'm not quite sure what he was trying to attempt here, certainly asking an awful lot of McCann. And that's a free kick against the Hearts player. Celtic in a hurry to get on with things, but the referee wants the kick retaken. There was a bit of a breakdown in communication there between Fulton and McCann. And then there was a free kick awarded against the Hearts player.
I think he was just getting pressed, a little pressure from midfield, so he didn't have many options. So he just thought he'd play in the space and let McCann chase Anoni. But Reaper was too clever and experienced to get there first.
Touch on there by Lambert. Fulton challenges. That's a free kick against Burnley. And the Hearts players are not happy at all with Burnley. I feel that he went into this challenge and could have done a bit of damage here with his elbow to Fulton, and
he calls his involved, Jerry. Just out of a shot, V Cos got involved in a tussle with Gary Locke, who fell to the ground, and the Hearts players didn't like it. But there's been a bit of that going on constantly throughout this first half. So V Cos was the culprit in that occasion.
A lot of players are squaring up to one another there for the moment, but the referee has calmed things down, and the free kick will be taken now by Fulton. Naismith. The play there by Adam, losing his strength again, holding off Reaper. In comes McCann, claims for the use of a hand, but it's not given. McPherson's here getting a touch. Well, the Celtic fans behind Jonathan Gould's goal were claiming there that Neil McCann had used a hand and an arm to control that ball, but the cross came in and McPherson got a touch on it. The Celtic supporters just behind that goal were certainly unhappy. Now there are two players on the deck, Stephen Mahey of Celtic and Gary Locke of Hearts, both going for this ball and both injured in the attempt. It is getting mighty tough out there now.
There's so much at stake, you know, but there's a few edges getting lost here, and just got to calm it down. Bobby Tate, yet to show anybody a card, but I think if this continues the way it's going, I think Bobby will need to bring it out.
There is a tremendous atmosphere inside the ground. The challenge says so much at stake this afternoon, and referee Bobby Tate really has his hands full with this one, but he's trying to let the play flow as much as possible. So there's the Celtic bench this afternoon, the substitutes, and Darren Jackson, David Hannah, and Simon Donnelly. Meanwhile, the referee's having a word with Gary Watt, but happily, both players are back on their feet, and now the match will restart with the free kick to Celtic, taken by Alan Stubbs. Send out towards Anoni. Played by Ritchie. Done by Lambert. Powerful clearance there by Weir. It's actually cleared by Mark Reaper. But the referee has indicated in actual fact it's a Celtic throw. Much to the displeasure of the Hearts fans, but just took a deflection there of Stefan Adam. Fulton's closed down very quickly there and effectively by Burnley. So they have the throw. There's Burnley again. Cross now for Mahey. Lock goes to meet him. Still it's Mahey for Celtic. Challenge goes in. That's a goal kick, indicates the referee. But Mahey got a bit of space there initially on the left-hand side, and then Gary Lock came out to meet him. Shows you the changing face of football. Celtic hit 8 goals in 4 league games against Hearts last season. All of the scorers have departed. Van Hooydonk, De Canio, Cadet and O'Neill. This shows you what a turnover there has been at Celtic Park. This is the arrival of Vin Janssen. And still they seek their first goal here this afternoon with some 31 and a half minutes gone. Still did a good start though for Vin Janssen. There's a trophy already in the boardroom. He's challenging for the championship, but so to our hearts. Let's filter. Sending it through, looking for McCann, but Anoni was there. Here's Smith's header. It's picked up though by Jackie McNamara. This is Henrik Larsson. Naismith sticks well to the task. A little miscue there by Ritchie. Stabbed away though by McPherson. And as far as stops. Switch up there towards Mahi. And once again, Gary Locks there. Closing down that area. McPherson challenges now with Ratbeck. Salvatore. Salvatore keeps his run going. Good play by him. Adams in the middle. McCann's arriving as well. Well, that's a complete mishit by Alan Stubbs. Corner. Two Hearts. Well, he seemed in the roll. Great pressure there. There's no Hearts player close to him. But, certainly Adam was arriving. And so too was McCann. That was excellent running by Salvatore. He got a good pass, first of all. Then ran down the right-hand side. Well, Celtic a problem. So it's McCann who swings it in. It's punched away by the goalkeeper, only as far as Fulton. He's facing a packed defence here. This is Cameron. Played by Reaper. Touched by Fulton. And can play there by Lambert. He read that situation well. Just took the sting out of things.
Plenty of opportunities Hearts to put Celtic under real pressure, but it's never really came. Other than that initial shot in the first couple of minutes from Cameron. Been disappointing up front so far. Adam's really very little service. So they've got to try and get McCann more in line with going forward rather than hugging this left side.
McCann battling with Anoni. Looks now for Lambert. Switch of play to Stephen Mack. The cost, he's got Ratbeck with him. And he held on to it there, the cost, and he got the free kick. And he had Harold Ratbeck making a run for him on the left-hand side. But he kept possession here, and he won Celtic the free kick. David McPherson challenging. Forward to see if he can repeat what he achieved here in October. It's Henrik Larsson over the ball. And it's just beyond Reaper, who was closely watched by David Weir. Well, Hearts have failed to beat Celtic in the league in the past couple of years. Celtic had two wins and two draws last season, and two victories so far this season. In fact, if you go just a little bit further back, won all four league games against Hearts, so the Tynecastle club's record not good against Celtic in recent years. All of that will be quickly forgotten if Hearts can master this situation this afternoon. Celtic have come closer so far, with one cleared off the line, one off the base of the post. But this is McCann now. Can he inspire Hearts? The challenge goes in there from Jackie McNamara. The referee had a think about that one, and he's given the free kick. Now, McNamara's not happy with the decision. He certainly got the ball. The referee did not react for some time, and certainly there were no protests of any note from the Hearts players. Bobby Tate had a think about it, blew the whistle, and pointed down. Free kick to Hearts. So once again, push the big man forward. Person is up there, so too is Weir. Reaper gets things organised. It's Fulton who clips it forward. But, Free kicks have been disappointing from Hearts so far, but still have possession. McPherson sends in an awkward one. This is McCann getting a touch. The goalkeeper commits himself. Gould gets it away only as far as Fulton. Well, that was well read there by Lambert. He certainly has been sitting in deep this afternoon. He's read several situations very well indeed. Meanwhile, Celtic tried to break forward now. Anoni's on the right-hand side screaming for the ball. Burnley's in possession now, but Anoni's space has been cut down a bit. It's played now shot to Jackie McNamara. A hopeful ball by him. And it ends in disappointment for Celtic.
Really very little option. He was in a pressed area. Well, there's not much space anyway, McNamara, but you've got to have your strikers. That's the time your strikers have got to have an understanding of one coming short and one into space. So far, Brattback hasn't really done much through the central role.
This is McCann. Move for Adam. Salvatore. Fulton. Cross now for Weir, who's closed down by Brattback. Well, Weir makes an absolute hash of that under pressure. It's true now for Henrik Larsson, who's showing good pace here. And the goalkeeper did extremely well. Ronnie McKenzie took the responsibility there. He had to leave his line early, and he did so. And he took that one comfortably. That'll do his confidence a lot of good. And well, it's Salvatore sending through. Nice left there by Cameron. Lovely touch by Stefan Adam. It's Cameron again. He's got a lot to do here. Well, he almost found an opening. Another awkward clearance here by McPherson, and this has put Locke under pressure. Nice switch of play there by Vikost. McNamara's under pressure though. Ron Cameron, he does well, he finds Enrico Anoni. Now he's against Naismith. He's got backup again from Jackie McNamara. That's in looking for Larsson. And applause from Henrik Larsson for the delivery of that ball.
Well, it actually deserves better than applause. It deserves a goal. McNamara initially started this build-up, then he's keen to get back on it. Brilliant cross in. He just needs to keep it down. He's stretching a little bit. You see McNamara, look, he's picked his spot already. He's telling Larsson, get in there, and I'll put it for you. Beautiful delivery.
So just under 6 minutes of this first half left. Still no scoring here at Tynecastle, but plenty of incident. And it's McNamara again for Celtic. Larsson. Only tried the first-time pass there in the direction of Vikost. He's claiming the free kick. The referee moves play on, and now it's at lock for Hearts. Fulton, lovely touch. McCann. Good skills by McCann, but Anoni stuck with the task. And again, the game going on. With the cracking pace here. And no one being allowed any time on the ball, as you would expect in a match of such importance. This is Mahi. Salvatore challenges. Chances on now for Henrik Larsson. McNamara! Celtic take the lead! Jackie McNamara! With just over 40 minutes gone here at Tynecastle, it's McNamara with his third goal of the season who makes the breakthrough. Delight on the face of the Celtic player.
Brattback finally gets the ball through the centre. Gives it to Larsson. Hearts are all over the place. This is a guy who's composed. The last 10 minutes he started to make an issue in this game. Hearts defensively are all over the place here. Naismith is sucked in. Good composure. Stick it in the corner. Keeper can't do much. I think it gets a little touch in the end. You see, the issue is made. You run at the heart, the defence. You've got to make decisions. You can break anywhere. Folks, for Jackie McNamara, delighted to tuck it in.
Well, Celtic player on the deck, and Hearts have a free kick. Paul Lambert has taken a knock into a challenge there, and it's actually Hearts in fact who've got the decision. But Celtic there will have cheered up Wim Jansen no end. They've been threatening to score. Just before that, Larsen had missed an excellent opportunity set up by Jackie McNamara. Stubbs had a shot off the base of the post. Another anxious moment for Celtic. Certainly earlier in the game, Enrico Annone took a severe knock. He got back to his feet and he's been okay since. But as that challenge was made there by Lambert on Cameron, it was a Celtic player who took a knock. And he was also judged to have conceded the free kick. Has shown his fine defensive quality so far this afternoon. He's also scored two goals since arriving at Celtic, and both you could describe as spectacular. One against Rangers and one against Motherwell. So happily for Celtic, he's back in his feet. Hearts have an opportunity to get themselves back into this game. It's Fulton who sends it forward. And Watkins in to try and create something, but it's behind for the goal kick. Skipper, we have to try and lift the players around him. There are more experienced hands on the field. So the final minutes of this first half ticking away. Celtic lead by 1-0. Jackie McNamara. But it's Hearts now in possession. It's Stefan Adak. McCann floats it in, but there's no one there. No Hearts jerseys at all in that vicinity. For Larsen. Burnley challenges there with Fulton. A little battle going on between the two number eights this afternoon. This is the cost, lofting it forward. And Cam defending by Gary Naismith. Interesting now to see if Neil Poynton can get his place back in this Hearts side. He's indicated he's leaving at the end of the season, and Jim Jeffries may be tempted now to stick with the youngster, who certainly has done his chances no harm with recent performances. Meanwhile, it's Weir trying to get Hearts forward. So by Fulton, first time ball by Adam, but it's a poor one. Roll to Mahé. Covered again, though. So we're inside the final minute of this first half. Celtic lead by 1-0. That's a poor ball there by Fulton. The bricks on now for Celtic. It's McNamara playing it through. Lovely ball to Henrik Larsson. And the goalkeeper got a touch on it, but it was a poor effort by the Celtic player. No doubt about that. But it was Brattbank again with another good run, who set up the chance for Celtic. Nice little ball through initially by Jackie McNamara to Brattbank. And he rolled it into the path of Larsson, who should have done better. There's a couple of chances I've got a begging from Henrik Larsson in this first half. Here he is now, though. Teeing it up for Jackie McNamara. He takes a touch on it. So Roddy McKenzie got a touch in this one just a few moments ago. McNamara, a nice little ball through to Harold Brattbank. And he picked out Henrik Larsson, perfectly weighted pass, should have done better, I think there's a message there. Keeper got a touch on it, but the shot was rather weak.
Yeah, it was a weak finish. Again, Hearts are indecisive at the back. They don't know whether to play offside or whether to just sit back. And it's young Naismith who's kept him on as a half-time whistle goes.
So the whistle sounds. Jackie McNamara is a player who made the breakthrough for Celtic. There's no doubt that Celtic were the better side in the first half. They created a number of chances. Alan Stubbs was unfortunate with one off the post. It was another ball cleared off the line, but McNamara made no mistake after 41 minutes, picked his spot in the far corner as the ball broke away from Henrik Larsson. The half-time score here at Tynecastle is Hearts 0, Celtic 1.
Yes, Hearts 0, Celtic 1 at the interval here at Tynecastle. The views of Craig Brown and a look back at the first half action coming up after this short break. Welcome back. Half-time here at Tynecastle, where it's Hearts 0, Celtic 1. And let's have a look at the story of the first 45 minutes at this game. There we are, the first half statistics. Well, it's 1-0, we know. Hearts have had 3 shots on target, Celtic 2. 7 off target for Celtic, none off target for Hearts. And Connors, Celtic win that one, 6-1. Craig, what do you think? Celtic have got a grip of this game, haven't they?
They have, yes. Undoubtedly, after the first 10 minutes or so, Celtic were in dominant mood. And it was very much like the Aberdeen game. Aberdeen started well. There's something about Celtic, they don't seem to start really positively, but after they settle down, they've been well in control of the game.
And we spoke beforehand about Jackie McNamara, and that was fortuitous because he has opened the scoring here, Craig. And you do like this fellow, let's re-emphasise that, he is a good player.
Yeah, absolutely. I think Bobby Tait did well there. He could have blown it, looked like a penalty, and he delayed his decision, gave the advantage to Celtic. I'm quite sure there that was a penalty kick, but Bobby, the referee, delayed, and of course Jackie McNamara was in great position following up. What's happened here is this, that Anone has been pulled wide to Mark McCann, which allows Jackie freedom on that side. Now that's helped, the system that Hearts have used has helped Jackie McNamara to get to freedom.
He's got some space.
Exactly, and had McCann not played as wide, Jackie might have had to hold that wide position. But he's been free and he's been in goal scoring chances once or twice, and opportunities have risen and he's been there. So brilliant backup play by wee Jackie.
Well, Colin Cameron had a chance early on for Hearts as well, Craig.
Yeah,
and this may have changed the way the game went had he got this one in.
Exactly, the first goal's vital obviously, and Cameron did very well, and that was an excellent save by Jonathan Gould. He got over there with his right hand, when it looked nearer his left hand, but he did exceptionally well, and that would have been a critical moment had that one gone in.
A good save by Gould, but at the other end, McKenzie looked a bit shaky. We can see this now because Salvatore had to come to his rescue and dig it off the line, didn't he?
Yeah, he looked a bit nervous, the young goalkeeper, and I was praising him at the beginning, but he certainly was unsettled for a spell, and Celtic perhaps could have put him under a bit more pressure by throwing balls in there, but he was clearly at fault in that case, and I think he would admit to it.
And the Celtic fans behind us thought Weghorst had scored earlier on, Craig. It was a huge roar from them, but the goal was chalked off, and rightly chalked off in your view.
Well, I think so, yes. He seemed to arm the ball before he shot it, and it was breaking away from him, and the left arm was just in a very helpful position there to control the ball. But it was very well finished through a mass of bodies there, and Weghorst playing well, and he finished that well, so don't give him half chances inside the box is the motto for Hearts at the half-time.
And once again, Craig, Wim Janssen's pre-match plan has gone right. He's a good pre-match planner, isn't he?
Yeah, absolutely right. Well, what's happened is they've marked the one striker, and that's been Adam, and they've pushed Anone wide to pick up McCann, and they've marked very well in midfield, and in fact, it's been a match-up job in midfield. And of course, with Paul Lambert doing so well and Colin Cameron, I think Celtic tactically have got it absolutely right.
Absolutely right. Okay, it's all going well for Celtic. Well, now details of how you can vote for the Bells Man of the Match. All you have to do is decide who's the best player on show here at Tynecastle this afternoon and then phone in your selection on 0891 333 301. That's 0891 333 301. The lines are open now and we'll announce the Bells Man of the Match just before the final whistle. Okay, we'll be back for the second half here at Tynecastle after this short break. Hello again, we're just waiting for the teams to re-emerge for the second half here at Tynecastle, where it's Hearts 0, Celtic thanks to Jackie McNamara 1. At the interval, that's how it stands right now. Craig, we've enjoyed it, and Alan Stubbs has had a good first half for Celtic. He went close with that shot off the post, which McKenzie didn't know a lot about, did he?
Exactly. Well, if that had been in the target it was in, the young boy was stranded there, but all credit to Stubbs, because with the corners Celtic have had, they've remained up the big boys, Reaper and Stubbs. Stubbs in particular is always a goal threat.
Yeah,
and he's remained there confidently. This was a bit of an error too, the goalkeeper misjudging it. And Larson is a strike, and of course it just headed clear by David McPherson.
It's been a difficult first half for McKenzie at times. Obviously the pressure does get to all the players.
I think it started with that pass back. There was an indecision between David McPherson and the young goalie. And I think Charlie said that Davey was the key man. He should have swept it away for a corner or a throw-in. And of course there was a wee bit of argument there, and I think that unsettled the young goalkeeper.
Well, he's got it all to do. What will Jim Jeffries have said for the second half?
Well, I think he'll think of a tactical switch soon, because I would imagine young Hamilton, Jim Hamilton, who's always a goal threat, will come off the bench. and maybe move Neil McCann in a central position.
They'll probably change it. Okay, the second half is about to get underway. You can see the teams out behind Craig and myself. Let's back over to Jerry McNee and Charlie Nicholas.
Thank you, Jim. And as you can see, Celtic are just waiting to kick off here. Interesting to note that in the 74 previous Premier Division games, Hearts have only once beaten Celtic after the Glasgow club have opened the scoring. Celtic have done that this afternoon, so Hearts have an awful lot to do here in this second half. So a final check by the referee with his assistants. There will be a goal for the second half, and the ground shows no changes to either side. Hearts have Jim Hamilton, Jose Katongo and Thomas Flogel on the bench. Celtic have Darren Jackson, Simon Donnelly and David Hannah. So there'll be plenty of talking from Jim Jeffries, I would imagine, at half-time. We'll be looking for a lot more in the second half, but really Hearts have got to carry the game more to Celtic. Well, that's not the case at the moment. Celtic are going in looking for number two here. And that ball looked out of play. It's a corner. Gary Naismith just failed to control it. So Celtic start the second half in a positive fashion. I don't think there's any doubt the way Hearts have lined up here this afternoon. But they really handed Celtic a bit of a boost. And Celtic simply cashed in during that first half. They've carried the major threat. There's the goal scorer in the afternoon so far, McNamara, who swings it in. Just beyond for the goal kick. Reaper. He's got a couple of goals since joining Celtic, Mark Reaper. He's certainly stiffened up the defence. Celtic going into this match this afternoon with the best defensive record. 16 goals lost in the previous 23 games. Perhaps our scoring rate could be just a little bit better. 42 in those 23 games. It's not a bad record, but Hearts and Rangers are ahead of them in the goal-scoring stakes. But in this match that matters a lot this afternoon, it's Celtic in the lead and it's Celtic on the attack, and it's Burnley showing his positive side once again. That's another corner to Celtic.
Very positive start to the second half from Celtic. Again, clever running from midfield. Ekos and Burnley impressive. And again, putting pressure on Hearts.
Once again, Reaper moves forward to the six-yard area. It's in the ball just beyond him, and it's Vikost who gets in the effort. Well, we were talking earlier, Charlie, we see this this effort going in from Morten Vikost. We were talking earlier about the spread of goals from Hearts, but the Celtic midfield are certainly delivering goals this season. You know, when you look at the likes of Burnley with 11, Vikost with 6, Lambert weighing in with a couple, and Jackie McNamara raising his to 3 this afternoon.
Yeah, no, that's his game very positive in midfield for him, as Cameron gets a free kick from Bobby Kay there. But they have done that well, Celtic. Everybody talks about Hearts, but Celtic defensively have been solid. So 1-0s and 2-0s are enough for Celtic these days. It's a clear free kick. I think Stubbs is going to actually get to the ball first, but Lambert's got his arms up.
So a chance here for Hearts to get themselves back into the game. Cameron certainly impeded there by Lambert. And how Hearts need a piece of inspiration here. Well, it's Stefan Adam. There's Jonathan Gold looks on. Stefan Adam and Stefano Salvatore. They're in close proximity to the ball. The referee, meanwhile, watch the Celtic defensive wall. Could retreat just a bit. So Stefan Adam it is, who starts the run forward. Breaks out now for Fulton. Switch of play to Locke. Cameron is still full of running, but he's shattered all the way there by Stefan Mahe. And it's Celtic's ball.
Again, those set pieces from Hearts have been really disappointing. I think the manager, Jim Jeffries, would be furious. They haven't really made anything count at all in the set pieces, and yet they've had them in good areas.
This is McCann. And now for Locke, the early ball from him. It's a good one to the far side. Well defended by Reaper. Well, it's Larson trying to get forward. Good challenge there by Paul Ritchie. Matt Brooks for Burnley. Switch a play to Mahe. Back's ahead of him.
now running into the middle as Martin Vikas picks up the play for Celtic. Coming away from David McPherson, there's a bit of holding going on there, but it's Weir now who emerges with possession for Hearts, trying to drive them forward. Adam's ahead of him, he's got Cameron in support. This is Adam. It's Weir again. Challenge there by Mahi. Play on, says the referee. Chance for Celtic now to break. It's forward by McNamara. Little touch there by Larson, but not a good one. It's picked up now by Naismith. This is McCann. Lambert's back there providing cover again, and when he was there also. It's McNamara for Celtic. Looking for Larson, who squandered a couple of opportunities in the first half. He battles hard there, but the odds are against him. It's Ritchie who gets it away. And it's a free kick now against Burley. Again, the two number eights clashing. And the battle continues between this pair, Burley and Fulton. So Celtic holding that precious lead at the moment. Brought about by Jackie McNamara's goal in the 41st minute. By Naismith. Eluded two Celtic defenders. It's Stefan Adam trying the shot there, but Alan Stubbs stuck well to the task. Good blocking challenge there by Alan Stubbs. Well, Hearts have certainly been impressive in recent times. They've hit 16 goals in the last 7 games. They've managed 3 shutouts in the last 5. Until looking across Celtic and McNamara this afternoon. So really, Celtic are still looking the likelier side, a bit more up for this match this afternoon. Hearts are really going to have to settle quickly in this second half, start stringing some passes together. It's not going to be easy, mind you, in this atmosphere.
Dennis McCann getting involved with a tussle. Tackle from behind, so it's a clear foul. Again, McCann's got to influence the game. He's in a wide position and I know he's been comfortable with them. So he's got to change the pattern again for Hearts. It's up to people like him to change it.
Here by McPherson, touch on by Adam. Lambert's there for Celtic. It's Naismith. Adam. Oh, good play by Adam, getting away from Lambert. Anoni is giving chase, Reaper's backtracking. Still it's Stefan Adam, trying to find an opening here. He just couldn't get any real power into the shot. He had a lot to do there. And well, at the other end, it's David McPherson having to do some defending against Brett Beck. Will perhaps give Hearts just a little lift there. That was good play by Stefan Adam, and that's a foul now by Stefan Mahi. On Gary Locke. Free kick to Hearts. They've been asking a lot, Hearts, this afternoon of Stefan Adam. He's up there most of the time, very much on his own. He is a good, strong player. This is a good shot, but he needs more support. Meanwhile, it's Fulton floating it in. A touch on by Weir. A bit of a miscue there by Reaper. It's a corner to Hearts. So an opportunity here, and again to push the big man forward. And David McPherson is up there. And Weir is being carefully watched also. A bit of a footing going on there as McCann eventually sweeps the ball in. The keeper's in trouble there, and Jonathan Gould seemed to have lost that one for a moment, but managed to touch it over the top.
Yeah, it's good pressure corner. He won in a good area. Adam's in and about Jonathan Gould. It's difficult for him. And suddenly Celtic are under pressure, but this is what Hearts have to do.
And another corner comes in now, and Celtic is getting away. It's returned by Salvatore. A touch there by Anoni for Celtic. It's hammered upfield now by Mahi. Carefully watched by Locke. Larson's coming in to try and pressure him. This is Naismith. Positive run. There are too many Celtic players around him. Cameron tries to get forward. He's well challenged though by Jackie McNamara. Good ball now through by McNamara. But, the final cross there. Another poor one. Paul Lambert pushing forward there in support, but the final delivery wasn't good.
That was an opportunity. I've seen Hearts again when Naismith had done well, broke out of defence, and again is lacking options up front because McCann is still hugging that left side, and only Adam is his option, and it's difficult for him to take in against two big strong centre-halves at Celtic have. He's got to come in and link up a bit more, and that would at least give Cameron some more opportunities to get involved in the match.
So just over 10 minutes of the second half gone here at Tynecastle in Edinburgh. Hearts 0, Celtic 1. Jackie McNamara the scorer, just 4 minutes from the interval. Hearts are battling hard now to try and get themselves back into this game, but again, Celtic standing firm. It's Mackie. Lambert. It stops. Way beyond Bratback. Well, the goalkeeper left his line there, and Weir took a look at things and then decided just to sweep it out of play. There's no doubt the loss of Weir last week against Dundee United unsettled the Hearts defence. David McPherson coming and plugged the gap. He's held his place this afternoon. But then with the loss of Roussey as well, Hearts are having to dig deep into the resources. They're going to be champions and keep this challenge going for some time. They've got to show that they have the pool of players. But that's a corner now. Larsen chasing hard there, showing persistence. Perhaps making up a bit for a couple of opportunities he squandered. He's up to put Gary Naismith under pressure. Celtic have the corner. And once again, Reaper comes forward into the 6-yard area. It's played short though. Stubbs is up there also. This is McNamara delivering the cross. He does well to get that one in. It's away by McPherson. And colliding with Naismith there as he tried to clear that one still. Celtic have possession. This is Burley. It's a decent cross again. Larsen comes in. And amazingly, Harold Bratback from virtually on the goal line sends it over. It looked as though Hearts had shot themselves in the foot again there. Defensively, they were all over the place. Larsen got a touch. And from just a couple of feet out, Bratback sent it over the top.
I think Celtic should have wrapped this game up. Larsen's done well, very sharp reaction. It is a stretching case for Bratback, but in saying that, he'd so much time, he probably could have took a touch on it. He still defends it, wouldn't have got back to him. Opportunity gone for Celtic.
Well, it's amazing that a player with the scoring pedigree that he brings with him, that he's missed such an opportunity. But as we mentioned earlier, Harold Bratback is taking quite a while to settle with Celtic. Just a one goal in 8 games so far. That came against Morton in the Scottish Cup. And he must know that even though, as Charlie said, he was stretching for that one, he should have tucked it away. So both Larsen and Bratback missing golden opportunities to put this game beyond Hearts. 1-0, they're still very much alive and fighting. This is Vikost. Need to switch the play. Well, I telegraphed that one, though, rather ambitious with it. It was cut out by McCann. Vikost got a little touch there. It's returned by Weir. Stubbs is under pressure here. He does a wise thing against Adam. He's standing in ceremony there. Ball out of play for the throw-in. Laid off by Locke. Now it's Weir delivering the cross. The flag has gone up though on this near side. And the assistant referee takes the flag down again as Celtic now try to break forward through Jackie McNamara. And Naismith's with him all the way. And in fact, that's Hart's ball. Good defending there by Gary Naismith. It's Jackie McNamara tight in against the touchline. Burnley's there as well. That's ball. there for Celtic. It's through by Vikhorst. That's too much for Henrik Larsson, not what's behind for the goal kick. Now, Celtic have not lost here at Tynecastle in the last six league visits since a 1-0 reverse back in October of 1994. A goal by John Robertson, a player with a terrific scoring pedigree against Celtic, but not even a place for Robbo on the bench this afternoon. He's at 14 career goals against Celtic, and certainly the way things are at the moment, there might be a few Hearts fans out there wishing he had the opportunity to come on. This is Salvatore. Two now for Adam. He leaves it to Cameron. Good running by Cameron. He's an awful lot to do here, though. Again, I know he makes up good ground there, gets in the challenge. Still Hearts have it, though. Positive play there by Weir. This is Locke. Running it, Mahe. Walk away to the far side. It's taken down by McCann. Again, Anoni's in there very quickly. Closing down his space. And just a bit unlucky there as McCann tried to link up with Cameron. But again, Enrico Anoni showed great pace. Closed down space quickly. Got in a good challenge. It will become a bit of a favourite with Celtic fans. It took him a little while to settle in. In fact, it took him a little while to be given his chance, but he certainly grabbed it, and he's shown in important games he can do a good marking job. And well, it's Henrik Larsson taking on Gary Naismith, twisting and turning, trying to get away from the defender. McNamara drives it through. Vikhorst was in there. This is Burnley trying to find an opening. Salvatore's there, though, for Hearts. Through now for Adam. Nice touch by him to Cameron. But Reaper got the touch for Celtic, who've got possession again through Jackie McNamara. He's supported by Burnley. McNamara keeps a run going. Excellent play by McNamara. Chance here for Celtic, and Larsson it was who flicked it through. Well, certainly Vikhorst and Brattbeck were up there.
McNamara's given them major problems down the right. He's just too quick for young Naismith and too clever at times. He's a real problem for them. They just can't control McNamara at times today. But for me, Hearts have got to change it. They've got to change some sort of a tactical move, even by a substitution, but Celtic at the moment, I think, they're comfortable.
Well, Katongo, as you speak, Charlie, is starting to ready to come on, but it's certainly Hearts have got to try and get up a few gears here and try and get some pressure on Celtic. To other options this afternoon. As I mentioned earlier, they've Jim Hamilton, the top scorer with nine goals, which have all come incidentally in the league championship, the former Dundee player, and Jose Katongo. He's got a couple of goals so far this season. The other option is Thomas Flugel. But Hamilton's also warming up as Katongo waits to come on. Perhaps don't do something quickly, they might just find that this entire afternoon runs away from them. And well, it's Mahe, getting it away for Celtic. Touch there from Stubbs, right back. Off the head of Fulton, Larsson challenge, he does well to hold off Ritchie. Ball shoots from McNamara, good early ball there from McNamara, trying to pick out Burnley. Forward now for Fulton. And he's very quickly closed down by Vikhorst. Does well under pressure, it's Salvatore. Good one from him though, straight to Anoni. Well, Hearts will get a chance now to make the change. And it's Salvatore signalling for to leave the field, Stefano Salvatore. And on comes Jose Katongo. Well, has to be hoped that his trickery can open up some space in the Celtic defence. But Celtic powering forward again, this is Mahe, and immediately it's Katongo who goes to meet him. Vikhorst. Switch of play for McNamara, the early ball from him again, it's read though by Ritchie. And Stubbs under pressure, does well, steps away from McCann.
through into space now for Larsen to chase, which is with him, using his strength. And in fact, that's a free kick against the Celtic player. Again, he showed great persistence here, Larsen, but he certainly pulled over the Hearts defender. Free kick.
I'm not so sure about that one. I think defenders got away with too much in the game. When it comes to that, he's purposely standing in front of him, denying the striker the opportunity to get the ball.
Well, it's Burnley. Looks for Gary Naismith. Little touch on by Adam, it's a good one from McCann. Not many options here, though Hearts are failing to get any players forward in support, but McCann did well to get the corner kick. But that was another classic example there of a Hearts player threatening, but no one around him if he'd got himself into a position to make the pass. Too many Hearts players standing watching from the midfield area, but they have the corner kick. And just a one goal behind. Weir challenges hard. Fulton's there getting a touch. It was Vikost who got it away. Now it's Larsen. He's very much on his own, but he does well there against Cameron. There he goes. And the free kick is awarded to Celtic's way. Cameron giving chase there all the way with Henrik Larsen. And again showed good determination.
Yeah, he's worked his corner very well up front. He's done what Adam would be wanting to do, chase things into the corner and get it, hold up, get the support. The credit to Cameron who chased, but he actually took the corner kick and he was one of the first back anyway, so keen to get involved again.
So a dangerous moment here for Hearts. They're trailing by one goal to nil. We certainly can't afford to lose another one here. That's McNamara, the goal scorer, to take this free kick. Swings it away to the far side, Stubbs is there, but so too is McPherson. Celtic have the corner. Still the pressure's on. Andy McKenzie gets things organised as Jackie McNamara makes the long run across field to take this corner for Celtic. So Rupert and Stubbs certainly pose a big threat at these set pieces. Sends it in. Good confident catch there by Roddy McKenzie. Good long kick upfield and only challenge as well though. Breaks off for Fulton. Camera. Kitongo. Good play by Kitongo, but just too many Celtic players around him. It was Burnley who made a good challenge there. So we're midway through the second half at Tynecastle. Still Celtic lead by one goal to nil. They're in possession through Jackie McNamara. Good early ball there from Mahé. It's Bratt back, but he wanted just too much time to try and get the angle right than that. He was challenged immediately. Again, it's McNamara though. Ball dropping in behind Henrik Larsen. Good first touch though. Through for Burnley. Tries one! And off the top of the bar. Excellent effort from Craig Burnley. Almost goal number 12 of the season. But again, good play by McNamara. That was a brilliant touch there by Henrik Larsen. First time effort from Burnley and off the top of the crossbar.
Yeah, it's typical Celtic. Good first touch from Larsen. But you've seen Burnley check his stride. He knew one thing, he was going to get the target. Wonderful effort from Burnley. So clever at doing that. With good vision from Larsen.
Certainly be adding to those 23 caps in the weeks and months ahead. Challenges again, and this time a free kick goes against him. And the former Celtic player Steve Fulton will take this one. The former Rangers player David McPherson in his second spell here now goes forward. That's played through. It's not a good free kick either. That's a throw in tight against the corner flag to Celtic. Well, I don't believe that. I think he was saying we worked all week in the training ground at these things, and Hearts can try to make an absolute mess of the opportunity, and that's what makes it so frustrating for the manager.
Fulton. McCann. Lock. Played off by Adam. Jackie McNamara digs in there with Lock. Just Fulton. Lots of making a determined effort here to get back into this game. It's Weir. Oh, Weir's badly caught there. He was overdoing things. It's Vikos now in possession. Brett back through the middle. Henrik Larsson's on the far side. Still it's Vikos. And a good challenge there by Paul Ritchie. He kept very cool indeed. There were three Celtic players breaking. Hearts couldn't afford another error. It was all caused by David Weir overdoing things in the middle of the park as he tried to get Hearts forward. So Ritchie to the rescue. But it's only a brief respite. Celtic have the corner kick. But meanwhile, Locke is injured. Gary Locke is on the deck and requiring some treatment. So the Hearts player is leaving the field. Celtic are taking the corner kick. This is Larsson. It's away by Weir, who made the mistake that led to the corner kick. It's good play there by Neil McCann coming back to help out. Run forward, and that'll surely be a booking now for Burnley, as that was a real opportunity for McCann to get forward, and Burnley has been involved in a couple of challenges like that. So the yellow card after the afternoon is shown to Burnley. Just a few moments earlier had almost got a second goal for Celtic, but now he gets a yellow card, and I don't think he can complain about that. So Hearts take the free kick that's aimed in towards Adam, who appeared to be barged there a bit by Reaper. This is McCann doing well, getting in a good cross, they're under pressure there. It's Lambert who gets it away, header there from Anoni. That's Jackie McNamara trying to get Celtic going again. And the referee indicating the throw-in to Hearts. Home fans getting right behind the side here. It's Kitongo who was trying to get forward there. The ball is out again, and it's a throw-in to Celtic. Certainly there's more activity over on the far side of the Hearts bench, but it's Celtic breaking forward here. Brack backs in space, the keeper's committed himself. Well, he did well, he was almost caught in no man's land. Ronnie McKenzie came racing out there. Brack back looked favourite to get to the ball. It looked as though the Celtic striker might be able just to lift it over the goalkeeper here. He was way out of his goal, but I don't know if he knew too much about it in the final analysis, but he got the break anyway. So another corner to Celtic. Again, it's Jackie McNamara to take it. And towards the near post this time. And it came off Stubbs and behind for the goal kick. The Celtic defender is claiming that he was impeded there, but the referee showing no interest. There was some activity over at the Hearts bench just a moment ago. Thomas Vogel looked as though he was coming on, but he's put the tracksuit top back on. So time is certainly running away from Hearts here. 73, just over 73 minutes gone. There's a number for the man of the match to call. 891 at the treble 3301. So the throw-in has been awarded to Celtic, and the assistant referee is unhappy, and in fact indicating now a foul throw by Celtic, so now it goes to Hearts. George Simpson and Alan Thurston are running the lines this afternoon, assisting Bobby Tate. Meanwhile, it's Larsson threading that one through. It's a good ball. Brattback's onside. Surely this time still it's Brattback. And again, he lets the opportunity go. And the free kick has been awarded. The ball had broken there for Craig Burley. But again, Brattback loses out on a golden opportunity. It was perfectly threaded through to him. He decided to cut in past Weir, that allowed McPherson to come back, and the opportunity was then lost. It's not turned out so far to be a happy afternoon for Harold Brattback.
But Celtic do have a real opportunity to tie it all up here. A free kick just outside the area. And this is certainly one man who carries a great danger in this type of situation. He scored a spectacular free kick against Aberdeen earlier in the season, but no real test there for Roddy McKenzie. So, just 15 minutes left here for Hearts to get something back out of the game. This is McCann, who's switched over to this near side, but easily dispossessed by Vikost. It's away by Mahi. It's McCann again. Percy runs forward to support him. Hearts are committing more and more players forward here. They'll have to be very careful indeed about Celtic breaking. It's Weir sending it in. Oh, a bit of hesitancy there by Celtic. A chance is on there for McCann. It's blocked by Reaper. And swept away by Stubbs. And that gets the home fans going now. But McCann there, certainly threatening. And again, good play, digging in there by Stephen Adam. It broke for McCann. And it was Reaper who managed to block it. And then it was Stubbs who made the clearance. Meanwhile, it's Weir for Hearts. Another high ball into the middle. The goalkeeper struggling here. Off the face of the bar, well, Gould was struggling all the way, but now Celtic can break. It's McNamara, he's got Larson, he's got Burnley as well, and Brackback. The early ball through now from Larson, trying to pick out Burnley. Celtic perhaps should have done better there, they had four players running forward. But what a lucky break at the other end for Jonathan Gould and Celtic, as the cross came over, the keeper was scrambling. He was in trouble all the way, and the ball came off the face of the bar. Well, Celtic know there's still work to be done here. Hearts know there is still hope. And this is Stephen Adam. And shielding the ball well. It's through by Cameron. Good by Reaper. Well, again, you can see McPherson hesitating there, looking back towards Roddy McKenzie, no one quite knowing what to do, but still have possession through Weir. This is Fulton. Fulton keeps it on going, it's away though by Stubbs, in comes Weir again for Hearts. And only watches us carefully against McCann. Forward now for Jackie McNamara. He's got Burley inside, who's in a fair bit of space here. Brackback started a run, but Weir did just enough there to cut that one out. It breaks now for McPherson. So Hearts trying to get forward here. Celtic sitting in, attempting to hit them on the break. It's Fulton for Hearts, looking for Katongo. Good challenge here by Mahi, now it's Burley, across for McNamara. Anoni starts to run forward on the right-hand side. Still it's McNamara. Anoni's calling for it. And he's challenged late there by Naismith. And he's been called over by the referee. Late challenge going in. And this will be the second caution of the afternoon. Burley was shown the yellow card just a moment ago. And now Naismith. But the game has been played in a good spirit. It's been a hard match, but played mainly in a good spirit. Just the two yellow cards, as I mentioned, from match referee Bobby Tate. So a bit of activity there now, and it's Thomas Flogel who's preparing to come on. A player who turned out just over 350 times for Austria Vienna.
Maybe a double substitution, Jed. I've also got Jim Hamilton.
Well, they certainly need his goals threat at this stage as well, but there's a bit of work to be done before these two players can come on. It's a free kick to Celtic. Can they finish it here? It's Larson. And a referee points down for the goal kick. So Hearts will now be able to make that double substitution. They've already committed Jose Kitongo, so this is the final throw of the dice this afternoon by Jim Jeffries. Still the wait to come on. Smith loses out there, it's picked up by Brackback. Now it's Vikost. Good running there by Stephen Mahi. Celtic have got plenty of players forward here. Oh, that's poor defending by McPherson. Brackback trying to lay it off there for Jackie McNamara. It wasn't a good ball, it's McCann coming back to help out. Still it's McNamara for Celtic, sending it through looking for Lambert. Well, good running there, good support from Lambert, but he knows he didn't hit that one quite the way he wanted.
No, he didn't catch it clean, but the opportunity was missed again by Bradback. And then a bad layoff from McNamara. He retrieved the situation. You see Adam and Colin Cameron now going off. You can wait for Hamilton and Flogo. I think this might be a bit too late for Hearts. I've got to really change something. We're now throwing everything on. Interesting to see how this last 10 minutes or so is going to go.
So certainly there is a fresh goals threat to Jim Hamilton with 9 goals. Comes into the fray, and Thomas Flogel has managed 6 so far this season. Flogel had offers to go to Holland, Belgium and France. He decided to come here to Tynecastle. We're hoping now that he can do something for Hearts in these final stages. It's cleared high into the air by David McPherson. Well, he won all of the major honours with Rangers, domestic honours, played in the Champions League. So he'd love to add something for Hearts. Making, incidentally, his 500th Premier Division appearance this afternoon, David McPherson. He'd wish it to be a happier occasion. Here's another chance on for Celtic. It's through for Burnley, and it's Fulton. Well, these two, as I've said, have been scrapping away all afternoon. And Fulton does extremely well there. The ball was just laid on for Burnley. But again, it's given away. It's Jackie McNamara, who's been hugely influential for Celtic again this afternoon. What a difference in his play since when Jansen arrived, pushed him forward from the right-back position, where perhaps his defensive qualities weren't everything they might be, but in this wing-back role, he's excelling. And this finishes it surely now, yes! Well, it's a missed hit. But the flag's up on the far side. The flag's up on the far side. The goal is being disallowed. Well, it seemed a complete miscue again by Bradback. But as the ball was delivered there, just offside, he didn't connect properly with it, it rolled into the net, but the flag was raised on the far side by George Simpson. So, still Hearts have a chance to do something in this match, still 1-0 to Celtic. It's a time running away from the home side. They've really just got to launch everything forward now. This is McCann. By Stouts. This is Henrik Larsson. Followed by Richie for Hearts. And when he's here again, good challenge by him. It's Jackie McNamara. Forward for Larsson. Burnley's running in support. Still it's Larsson. And McPherson puts in a good challenge. So it's Fulton. Laid off by Hamilton. And Fulton, as he made the forward pass there, was taken out of the play. And although there's an apology being offered, Lambert has been called over by the referee, and he's yellow carded. So Hearts alive and kicking here. They've still got a chance. It looked there as though it was all over for them, as Bradback tucks the ball into the back of the net. But the goal disallowed for offside. Now it's a free kick to Hearts. And a bit of a chat going on there between the Celtic officials and the linesman. That's a possession again through Fulton. One forward looking for Hamilton. This is McCann. Kitongo taking on Mahi. Solid challenge by him. Throw in. Two Hearts. It's Kitongo again. Holding off the challenge, it's Weir, that's a poor effort. Ball high in the air and dropping behind for the goal kick. Still Celtic have their narrow lead. Hearts in fact have scored just 7 goals in the last 7 games here against Celtic. And it's Celtic now who are preparing to make a change. And Bradback is the player going off. So he's substituted once again after another rather poor performance. He really needs his confidence built up. That is not happening. And he'll be replaced now by Darren Jackson. Well, he gets a special welcome here because, of course, he spent many years with Hibernian and played many Edinburgh derbies here. But he's long enough in the tooth not to let the crowd get to him. But right away, sees a free kick. So just over 5 minutes left for Hearts to take something from this afternoon. Rangers fans are looking on with interest here as well. There's an opportunity! Weir sends it in, the great save by the goalkeeper, by Gould. Well, the goalkeeper must have seen that one really late. It was Weir who stabbed it through. Great reaction from Gould, and he's under pressure again. And another good save, this time from Naismith. Superb save there from Jonathan Gould. Just watch this. It was Hamilton who laid it off. First time effort from Weir. Good save by the keeper. An important save by Jonathan Gould, which could mean that Celtic are top of the league in just a few minutes' time. But there could be further dramas to come here at Tynecastle. But that's a warning for Celtic. Taken by Anoni. It's led off by Locke. Followed now by Naismith. So Jonathan Gould, well, he's lost just 5 goals in his last 9 away competitive games, and that could be as important a save as he makes this season. And the Celtic push forward again through Burnley. Just under 4 minutes left. Celtic have the corner kick. So another opportunity for them to finish it all off here and take the pressure off themselves for the last few minutes. Evan Jackson's practically on the goal line. Reaper's up there as well. Vic Costa's challenging. And eventually it goes behind off Henrik Larsson. His goal here in the 2-1 win last October was the 700th away goal by Celtic in the Premier Division. He certainly had chances this afternoon to add to that. So it's Jackie McNamara, who's just been voted man of the match by our viewers, surging forward, setting up a chance here for Mahi! Off the underside of the bar and away by Ritchie. Again, McNamara was involved. And Mahi coming so close to his first goal for Celtic off the underside of the bar. But again, excellent play by Jackie McNamara, teeing up this opportunity for Stephen Mahi. And so unlucky.
Yeah, it's brilliant play. McNamara sucked 3 in. Good touch. And then the keeper does well. He moves on to the bar. It's a great strike from Mahi.
Well, the final minute sticking away. Chasing hard here for the equaliser. This is Naismith. Oh, the ball bobbled there. I think he was a bit unfortunate. The break's on for Celtic now. And when he's away in the run, as Henrik Larsson picks up possession, Burnley's in support. Darren Jackson's forward as well. It's through now for Jackson. Even McPherson's giving chase. That ball's out of play though. Well, Jackson's running with it, but the ball had clearly gone behind. And in fairness to Darren Jackson, the weight of the pass wasn't the best, and he had to do a bit of running around into a very tight situation, being pursued all the way by David McPherson. Just under 2 minutes left. So there is the man of the match, Bell's man of the match, voted by the viewers, Jackie McNamara. He also got the goal that separates the team so far this afternoon. Just about 90 seconds left, plus any stoppage time to be added on. Through now by Ritchie. Well, Hearts have still to go to Celtic Park, and they've still to play Rangers twice here and at Ibrox. There's a lot of football still to be played, and Celtic now facing a bit of pressure with just over a minute left. But now Anoni is being spoken to by the referee, and he'll become the third Celtic player booked this afternoon. Burnley, Lambert and Anoni, and Naismith also yellow carded for Hearts. The referee has handled the game firmly and fairly. So can Hearts cash in the final minute here at Tynecastle? They've pushed forward. It's wide of target. Well, the Hearts players are claiming there was a deflection there, but the referee points down for the goal kick. Certainly there was a lot of pressure on here.
It's David Weir who gets the last touch on it. But you could have threw a blank over the Hearts. aerial threat there. There's four of them all together. Again, no real variation in any of the set pieces. Like most of everything I've done today, is just phased out.
Well, Celtic held the league leadership for a week earlier in the season. They're now just seconds away from it. And it was a very important save by Jonathan Gould. And there's another effort going in, this time from Hamilton, as we move into stoppage time here at Tynecastle. Hearts showing defiance till the end, and it was Hamilton with the overhead kick. And it was just watched carefully there by Jonathan Gould. But it was McNamara who scored the goal, but Jonathan Gould, who's had a remarkable record since joining Celtic, made a hugely important save that might just make all the difference to this championship race. Omahi's struggling there. This is Kitongo. Weir sends it through, and Oni's there though. He's giving very little breathing space this afternoon to Neil McCann. And now Celtic have the throw. Deep inside Hearts territory. Another few seconds take away. That's almost a minute of stoppage time played here. With the throw, and Jackson just keeping things calm there in towards the corner flag. The referee checks his watch. And it's Jackson just keeping possession. Back now for Mahe. Touchdown there by Henrik Larsson for Jackie McNamara. Well into stoppage time, so let's McNamara. He slipped up at the vital moment. This is Flogel now trying to get forward. The two substitutes attempting to combine. The Celtic fans are bristling. They want to hear that final whistle, which will send the team to the top of the championship race. It's a throw-in though to Hearts. They're being urged on by their fans. Again, the referee has checked his watch. We've played 2 minutes of stoppage time here at Tynecastle. It's Kitongo. Can Hearts even things out at the top of the championship race? And the ball just beyond Weir, but still Hearts have it through Hamilton. Kitongo's there, twisting and turning. There's a chance on there for McCann. Kitongo! Was it Kitongo for Hearts? More than 2 minutes into stoppage time. Looks as though it might go to the wire. The final whistle sounds. What a dramatic afternoon as we watch this replay again. The final whistle is gone here. It was Kitongo, a deflection, and one goal apiece. What a finish, Charlie Nicholas.
Absolutely unbelievable. I have to say, though, you know, I don't think Hearts really deserved much from this game. They didn't really do enough for me today to convince me they could be championship winners. Celtic did, on the other hand. I thought they came out of this game with the most credit because they were the strongest side again today. The drama at the end, the deflection off Stephen Mahe, which he could do nothing about, but the changes the Hearts had to make finally paid their way. The Hamilton's persistence, and then it's a bit of skill and trickery from the Congo. It can go anywhere, the same happened for Celtic. They're breaking the first half. Flogel's in and about it. They've got to pressurise, and that's what they do well. And then they get a lucky break. Jonathan Gould this time can't feel Celtic in.
You've also got to say, Charlie, that Celtic had so many opportunities to finish this off, and really, maybe in the end, they can have no complaint.
They can only blame themselves, Jerry, because Brattback, Larsson in the first half, had various opportunities. Brattback in particular needs to find his goal-scoring touch, because if he doesn't, then other players will need to fill that post. So, you know, disappointment for Bradbach, but at the same time, Hearts have stole a point.
Well, let's join Paul Cooney now, who's with Jose Katongo and Jackie McNamara.
Jackie, how do you feel at the end of that? I bet you can't believe it.
Absolutely. Yeah, boys, right after that, totally dominate the match. Should have won the game with at least three or four goals, and disappointing to lose a crafty goal at the end.
It was so much like the Rangers game yesterday, because they dominated against Inverness, and you just felt as time went on, people were saying, is it going to be the same this afternoon?
Well, I don't know. I mean, we had the chances to kill them a few times in the match, which didn't do. They've been lucky enough to get that goal then.
What about your goal itself? You took it really well there, and it's a good time just before half-time.
Yeah, it was a good time for us to score. I think we're in command at that time. We hit the post and a few other chances, so it was a good time to score, but I was disappointed, didn't they? Took the 3 points today, but deserved.
Jose, you came on there, and what an impression you made. Tell us about the goal.
I think it's a very good goal, because we play very, very good,
dominated the
game, but we score 1 point. This is very good.
You are, as well as a skillful player, a lucky player. You seem to come on and get the goals.
Yes, I've been playing very good. The team, the moment, no have chance, but I do my best. Come on, score goal. This is the team.
You think Hearts can go all the way now?
Yes, I think so, because 1 point, we three in the top. See what happens next week.
Okay, the cup next week for you, and for you, Jackie, of course, back to Dunfermline and then back to the league after that. But I could see the players going up there. But everybody's all square. The championship starts again from here.
Yeah, still at the same points. Should be interesting round from the lab.
Okay, well, thanks for joining us. And Jose, could you present the Man of the Match award to Jackie McNamara? I know the Hearts fans would want it to go to you, but the Bells Man of the Match is Jackie McNamara. Well done.
Okay, thanks.
There we are. Well, Hearts 1, Celtic 1, right at the death. Katongo scores. We'll hear the thoughts of Scotland boss Craig Brown and gather reaction from the dressing room area in just a couple of minutes from now. Get your breath back and don't go away. Welcome back. Well, it finished Hearts 1, Celtic 1 here at Tynecastle this afternoon. The late equaliser from Jose Katongo. We've heard from him. Let's hear now from Jim Jeffries, who's with Paul Cooney.
Yep, I've managed to drag him out of the dressing room. Jim, how did you feel when the ball hit the back of the net there?
Oh, a great feeling. Celtic obviously had the better chances, more so in the second half when we were pushing forward, changed the system to try and get back in the game. No point in going down. You know, we're down 1-0, never looked like scoring. So we had to throw people on, and you know, you've got to give the players credit the second half. They battled the way we felt. We got to them at half time. Never felt like, again, the situation where no believing in themselves and letting people down. But at least they gave me the effort the second half. And Celtic are a hard team to beat. And
they had so many chances. Did you feel it was going away from you?
Yeah, they had chances because Hearts were pushing forward. When we changed it and took off our defensive midfield player in Salvatore, then obviously we were taking a gamble because we are in a four. Attacking the team. So once we got that, we were always liable to get caught, and we just rode our luck a wee bit, but at least it was a never say die attitude. And when the chance we felt that we Jose, he stuck it away. And it was a great feeling because,
psychologically, what does it mean for your team? You've taken a point now from the Old Firm.
Well, we've always said we've done a lot of good performances this year. Sometimes now it's about grinding out a result, and it doesn't matter how you play, the result's important. So with Rangers drawing yesterday and denying Celtic a chance to go top in us, we're all square still, and it was a great victory for us. And when you consider what we've put in the park, compared to what Celtic and Rangers have spent, and Hearts are doing tremendous this year, and they're still going to be in there at fighting to the death.
And what a reaction from your supporters and you there on the bench right at the end. I mean, 2 minutes injury time, we're all thinking Celtic were going top, but your players would never lie down.
Well, the supporters stuck with us there and got right behind us. I know I'm a supporter myself, and obviously we were looking to, you know, try and just maybe snatch one to death. We certainly put them under a wee bit more pressure the last 10 minutes.
Are you going to win the title?
We've got a chance. So, but okay. Well, you know, we've partnered everybody else well, but and Celtic and Rangers have been stepping up, so we've got a draw against them, and now we can maybe see about handling the rest now from the one that we in.
Jim, quite an afternoon. Thanks very much.
Great, thanks.
Jim Jeffries and the capital jig there, Craig, in the middle of the field, just to make it all. Here's the story of the 90 minutes. Let's have a look at the statistics of this game this afternoon. Here we are. Well, we can preempt it. It was 1-1, we know that. Shots on target, 7 to Hearts, 5 to Celtic. Shots off it, Hearts had none, Celtic had 10. yellow cards, 3-1 Celtic, red cards, thankfully there were none. Craig, did you enjoy the game? It certainly was thoroughly entertaining, wasn't it?
Yeah, a great game. I thoroughly enjoyed it. I did diplomatically predict a draw, and we got the draw, but it should never have been a draw. Celtic had the greater possession and more chances in the second half, and I couldn't believe them conceding possession out wide in the left. We're in injury time.
Yeah.
They had possession of the ball, and they elected to play it out of
there. You want to hold on to it. I think Darren Jackson threw the ball in maybe when he shouldn't have.
Well, maybe keep it in the corner so they kill the game, and the game just peters out then. But they played the ball across, and of course Hearts went up to the other end. And
scored.
I thought great tenacity from Hearts. That just typifies Jim Jeffrey's teams. They fight to the bitter end, and all credit to them.
And Paul Kinney is right when he said that Katongo has a habit of coming on and scoring a fairly crucial goal, and he's done it again. And let's have a look. At the end of the day, Craig, a deflection off Mahé.
Yeah, but great credit to Wee Katongo, because he was really persistent in there and he was determined to keep possession. And of course, when it broke to Neil McCann, Neil got his shot in, and then it came back and the deflection, of course, beat. And we thought Jonathan Gould was going to be unbeatable today, but only a deflection could have beaten him, and we saw it there. Yeah.
Harold Bradbeck must be scratching his head and wondering, when will he score, how will he score for Celtic in the league? This one, it can't come much closer than this.
No, but what you've got to say about Bradbeck is he's always in the position to score. Now, he's missing a chance or two, but, that happens to strikers, I'm sure. And, once he gets one or two, I think the goals will flow from him. But he's always in the place, and, of course, he's blamed for missing it.
Yeah.
But had he not been there and the ball had just spun past the post tamely, you wouldn't have been saying anything about Bradbeck.
And he thought he'd scored, Craig, shortly after that. But
frankly, he should have scored us.
Yeah, he thought he'd scored here.
Yeah, I thought, but he was definitely offside there. He moved just a minute or two too early. Had he stayed behind the ball before it was crossed and then gone on, we would have been okay, but he would have been all right. But
even
at
that, he kind of mishit it. He sclaffed it, but still... He
could still have got that ball by delaying his run. And, the strikers do that. They tend to just stop and then burst into the near post when the cross is played, so that they're onside. But he was too eager, I think, too enthusiastic, and went ahead of the ball. So
I know you'll be pleased, Craig, with David Weir coming on today. It was a surprise. His inclusion was a surprise to all of us. But he came on, played the 90 minutes, and almost got one by Jonathan Gould at the end here.
Yeah, David Weir did well. He was up in good support. That's a wonderful save, an excellent save. He has no time to get down there, but Jonathan Gould does exceptionally well. And, we thought at the time that would probably keep the 3 points going Celtic's way, but... we reckon without the persistence of Hearts.
And Mahé, the Frenchman, is quite an aggressive player. He's been quite a surprise all round.
Terrific
came
left
close
foot.
Towards the end here. Finger-tipped onto the bar by McKenzie.
See, there's Jackie. We were raving about McNamara most of the time. This is a very good save, and you've got to give the young guy, McKenzie, credit for that. He stood up well to it, managed to get it onto the bar, because it looked, to all intents and purposes, net-bound when it left Mahé's foot, but good goalkeeping.
And now it's neck and neck. Hearts, yeah. Celtic and Rangers. It really is fascinating the way it's developing.
Well, it's great. I think for the game here in Scotland to have such a climax to the season with the top three teams there, the goal difference isn't great either. It's very, very close, and it's a terrific mouth-watering prospect from now to the end of the season.
And it's going to take maybe just a mad 90 minutes for one of them and a poor one for maybe another to get a bit of daylight between these three, because
that's
there's
right.
Very little in terms of forms.
Yeah, because they're all looking at games they could have won, and the points that they've thrown away. But I think they've got to start now. Obviously, they'll do this and say, look, we don't throw any more points away, and we're very consistent from now. And the team that is consistent from now to the end of the season will win this championship. And I think it's wide open.
It is wide open. Let's hear what... Well, Wim Jansen must be a bit disappointed that Celtic didn't get 3 points. He's now with Paul Cooney.
Wim, how disappointed are you about that?
Yes, very disappointed about the result, of course, because I think we deserve to win this game. We were much better and we had a lot of chances to score the 2-3-0. We didn't do it, and then, you never know. You see, game is always 90 minutes and even more, and then you can get a goal. But I think the way we play was very good today.
Are you annoyed with your players, though, for not finishing off so many chances?
Yes, of course, you always want to finish that game, but the longer it takes, only zero, they get a chance, they change, and you never know what happened, and you see today.
And Harold Ratpack had a goal disallowed, then you took him off, and he had a few real chances. Do you think he just needs this goal to get confidence?
Yeah, if he scored the second goal today, the game was over. Everybody knew that, and the game may be a few seconds too long for us today.
What do you feel? You're a wily old fox. You've been in the game for so long. Luck plays a part in it. Do you feel the luck was against you there today?
Yeah, for the result, the luck was against us. The way we play, I think we did dominate the game and we had a lot of chances, and we should win this game normally today.
They used to say there's only two teams in Scotland. It's not the case now, is it? Hearts really are proving a real force.
Yeah, everybody knows we are three on top, and the coming games are very important for all the teams, and we know that. And today was very disappointed for us, and we have to leave this behind us and look to the next game, because the next game is even more important than that.
And maybe you'll be smiling after that one. Vim, thanks for joining us.
You're welcome. You're welcome.
Well, good for Vim Janssen. He's putting a brave face in it, and he's absolutely right, Craig, because Celtic dominated today, didn't they?
They did. They should have won the game, there's no question of that. As I understand, Rangers should have won yesterday. But as I said earlier, the persistence and the tenacity that is in this Hearts team means that they will never give up. They won't give up to the end of the season either. But normally you come to Tynecastle, you go away with a point, you feel that's okay. But what's annoying them is the way his team played. They played so well. Had they come here and it had been an even game and they got a point, they would have accepted it.
It wouldn't have been so disappointing.
But to play so well and only get a point must be frustrating for
McNamara, him. The most improved or the most improving player in the country?
Absolutely. You know, any time I see him now, he's outstanding. And, you know, he can't put a foot wrong these days. He's got a terrific engine, great energy, terrific vision. And, you know, I've been hearing he's been playing with a slight injury. So if that's him with an injury, we're looking forward to having him fully fit.
You, isn't he?
I would think so.
Craig, thanks ever so much. Thank you. That's about it for today. We're back on Friday at 7 o'clock with Extra Time, which includes a special report from Morocco as the Africans gear up to face Scotland in the World Cup. Compulsive viewing for the fans of the national coach. In the meantime, well, what a game you saw this afternoon. Hearts 1 from Katongo, Celtic 1 from Jackie McNamara. From Craig Brown and me, thanks for watching. Bye for now. Bye-bye.